The virus is an XL channel which may contain explicit language. Channel blocking is available by calling 1-800-XM-RADIO or in XM Canada, 877-438-9677.
And now, Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa. No reading, no research, just strong opinions.
All right, hey, what's up? It's Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa for another edition of the Uninformed Show. For what day is it supposed to be, Joe? November 22nd?
Yes.
So happy Thanksgiving to you, Joe.
Hey, Bill.
How did you enjoy your Thanksgiving that hasn't happened yet?
Well, even on the air date of this show, it hasn't happened. The Thanksgiving's on the 27th, I believe.
Why do you got to get technical?
Or the 29th? This is the Saturday before Thanksgiving today.
No, it isn't.
The 22nd is.
Thanksgiving is the third Thursday of every November.
Yeah, we're the Saturday.
7 times 3 is 21.
It's late this year. It's the last week in November this year.
No, it isn't.
Bill, yes, it is.
It isn't. I bet you right now, half our listeners aren't even listening because they're fucking asleep from all the damn turkey.
No.
That's my cell phone. I'm going to find out when this is. If you haven't noticed, we're pre-recording this show.
Yes.
From Washington, D.C.
So we're actually pre-recording it
a few weeks. You're right.
Of course I am. A few weeks before Thanksgiving, we're pre-recording this show in D.C., but it is airing right now, the Saturday before Thanksgiving. So happy Thanksgiving either way, Bill.
Okay.
You have any plans for the holiday?
You know what? I'm not doing shit. That's my plan. This year, I usually travel or whatever, and I'm not doing it this year. I'm not going Thanksgiving. Am I boring you?
No.
I literally just started to answer his question. Why don't I shut my damn phone
off? From my glasses. So you're going to lay around the apartment in Los Angeles?
Yep. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm not going home for Christmas, and I'm not working New Year's. Fuck everything.
I'm working New Year's, and I'm going home for both of these holidays. But that's all, you know. I'm a kid still. I'm 31. I still get the spirit, you know?
To do what?
I don't know. To eat some turkey and...
What are you, 31?
Presents? Yeah.
That's right. I'm 40, dude.
Yeah.
My mother's like upset that I'm not going home for Christmas, but it's like, what am I supposed to do?
It's Christmas.
Go there and get a racetrack, Joe?
You should go home for Christmas, dude.
No,
it's
there's
Christmas.
Something pathetic. Dude, there's something pathetic about going home for Christmas at 40, not married with no kids, dude. You're a loser. That's like being 23 still hanging out at high school. Where are the parties, man? It's the same thing, dude. It's the holiday equivalent. I'm not doing it. I don't think I'm going to see my parents again until I'm married and I have kids, and I just do what everybody else is doing.
And you're never going to see your parents again.
Why would you predict such an awful future for me?
Bill!
Do you know, I have a guy who every couple of months sends me an email and says, you're a miserable human being and you're going to die alone.
Ooh.
And every time it just hits me right in the chest. It's the perfect heckle because I'm never ready for it,
dude. This is what Christmas is, or the holidays.
Oh yeah,
you define
it.
No, I'm just saying you should spend it with the people that you love, and if that means you go home to your family and hang out with your family, then you go home and hang out with your family. There's not some rule that says if you're of a certain age and not married yet, you're not allowed to see your parents
on Christmas. Yeah, totally. There totally is. If somebody is 40 years old and they're not married and they're hanging out with civilians at the mall, they think you're gay. That's what they say. What are you, a fag? You get that as they're eating these people who allegedly love you, you get that stuff. And then you just get like, what's wrong with him? Why is he still drinking?
I don't know.
Joe, you know what Christmas has become to me? A giant mirror that I look into that just says you're a fucking loser, man. It's like the reverse of Snow White.
What is wrong with you,
dude?
Seriously. Go see your parents. It's Christmas.
I have 40 fucking Christmases in a row. I know what they look like. I know what they look like. Why don't they come and see me, Joe? When they were 40, when they were 40, they didn't go see their parents.
Because they were married and had a family that they had to
attend
to. But you don't.
Exactly. Who is this? Come on in, sir.
Somebody's coming into the studio.
This guy, he's got a beard, and he's got headphones. You a DJ? What do you do? He's blushing. I like him.
This is
the guy who was supposed to be here. Okay.
He was late. Were we at the fucking Bonnaroo Festival? Yeah. He looks kind of like a hippie. What's your name, man?
He just washed
Hi, Mike.
He just washed the mud off.
He seems like a nice guy. Mike, I'm Joe. Everybody introduce yourself to Mike, please.
Melba. From the improv is over there in the corner. Oh, is this how it's going to
look? Here's Bill Burr.
Don Wicklund. John Rickman just walked in dressed like
Fonzie.
He's dressed like an Armenian.
Don came blazing through the door.
Yeah. Can I ask you guys a question? Are you guys at any point going to just act like there is an actual radio show going on here? You're just going to burst in here and just totally let our listeners know how little respect you have for our show? Why are you dressed like you're in High School Musical? I don't like it.
The funniest part, did this not put the whole radio show in place today? When you go, hey, Don, since we're here, can we just go up to payroll and get our checks after the show? And he goes, good luck with that.
I know, it's unreal. He thinks it's hilarious.
XM slapping us right into place.
Then we got to get paid. Yeah, thanks for all the support on the XM Uninformed Tour. When are you going to send those banners?
Don, where are you going?
Yep, later. Have a good show. Bye-bye.
Okay.
See you guys.
All right.
Bye.
So we're going to have a new engineer every couple of minutes. Good
Lord. We got the new engineer.
Joe, you know, we do quality radio. I don't know what it is. Is that the way you say it in the industry? I could. Okay.
There's probably a term for it.
Do you have a microphone that you can talk? Because you're not going to sit there with your beard and not chime in on this show. Okay, that's not how it works around here. Oh, she does.
Yeah, we can share that.
Okay. Well, can you pass it over to him? Because I really let's just pass it over. I want to hear about his holiday plans. Basically, this is going to be nice. It's going to be good for the recording. The creaky XM mics. We're at the XM studios, people. Yeah, he was just giving me shit. We were on a nice little roll there. And then Don Wicklund came in. He really did look like he was going to pound on a jukebox, didn't he?
He came in blazing, man. Arms, chest out.
You know what it was? He knew we were going to make fun of him. So he had that fear, they're going to make fun of me. You attract what you fear. And to get the show back on track, Joe, that is why I am not going home for the holidays.
Why?
Because I'm going to attract what I fear.
What do you fear?
People are going to say you're a loser alcoholic and we're starting to think you're gay.
Bill, why would they say you're a loser? What, are you going to get drunk at Christmas
no,
dinner?
Joe,
None of you ever love me! Are you going to make
a scene?
No,
I'm a happy drunk, Joe, believe it or not.
Well, who's going to say you're an alcoholic? Who would say that? Your family?
My inner voice.
Jesus. Dude, go see your parents at Christmas, man. You're getting older. I'm not trying to be cryptic, but you're not going to have a lot of these left,
Joe,
dude.
I'm doing a college gig in the same state. I can see him then. And I don't have to get on a plane with 900 fucking fat people with presents.
When are you doing a college gig?
Huh?
When are you doing
Let's talk about the unbelievable, horrible shape that people are in this country.
No, wait a minute.
Talk about that.
Bill,
and
stick
talk about
on one.
Them, no, them loading onto the plane with all their crap in the overhead compartments. All their big slacks
that
folded up.
That thought just trailed off. You were hitting it hard in the front part of that statement, and I
why
thought you were
you just
going
roll
somewhere.
With it, Joe?
Dude, are you
why,
talking?
Why are you acting like you're interrogating me? Like you have to keep it on track.
Are you
talk about fat people on an airplane?
Are you
if I
talking
want to?
About fat people on the airplane at Christmas or in general? I don't under. I'm not following you.
Well, in general, not on Christmas, dude. Last year, this is what happened. I went to LAX like 3 days before Christmas to fly out. Not even. It was like 6 days before Christmas, and I felt like okay. You know, I'm doing a smart thing here. 6 days before, I'm going to be fine, dude. I went there. It looked like the government had collapsed. It was insane, dude. The line was out the door. Oh, my God. And all these guys, you know. Did you ever see those people? I don't even know where the fuck they're from. They don't even have a suitcase. They got that beat-up cardboard box with, like, 12 rows of duct tape going around it.
Yeah.
And then they have to take it out like, oh, you're going to charge me. I don't. Like, that shit is in front of me. And it doesn't put me in the holiday spirit. I'm still upset about it 12 months later, 11 months later.
This is my point. If you're willing to go through all of that horseshit to go play a college in Poughkeepsie or whatever it is, I would be willing to go through it to go home and see my parents at Christmas time. That is equally important. Just because there's not money involved doesn't mean it's not worthwhile.
No, this is what, Joe, I'm killing two birds with one stone. I'm going to fly out there. It is not going to be the zoo that it is during the holidays. I get on the plane, I go out there, I do the college gig, and I'm going to hang for 3 days with my parents. We're going to have a fucking great time.
All right.
Okay?
How close to Christmas is this?
Like 3 weeks before.
All right.
They'll have the lights up. I mean, Jesus Christ.
That's fine.
Look, Joe, we pre-record this show. I'm going to pre-record Christmas. Going to show up like 3 days before.
All right.
3 weeks before.
All right. Just know if you need a place to go, there's always a seat at our table. And
what am I, John Candy in Planes, Trains,
Mom
and Automobiles?
Makes quite a feast.
No, I
want to
create my own life. I got a great girl, and we're going to have a little Christmas tree. And it's all I have to buy one present.
Ugh, it just sounds awful. Just sitting in sunny L.A. and just no
Joe,
fucking
snow. Let's interrogate you now. When are you going to cut the umbilical cord?
Never, dude. I'm never. I love seeing my...
Hang on a second. You just got the sympathy. Aw.
Because I'm right.
From Mel.
I'm right. You spend the holiday with your family, dude. It's the one time a year that you guarantee you go home and you see everybody.
Yeah, but at some point, dude, you make a break from your family. Whether you have kids or not, dude.
I don't agree with that.
You think Kenny Rogers still goes home for Christmas?
Kenny Rogers? Why Kenny Rogers?
I don't know. This is the first old guy that popped in my head.
This is my
wow, did he get bad plastic surgery?
This is my
He looks like that chick on Desperate Housewives.
This is my point.
Those shiny faces, those Botox faces.
This is my point.
Laminated.
If you have your own family and it's like about your kids now and everything, that's different. I'm saying, but if you don't have that... You go home, you go to your family, dude.
You know, Joe, I don't say this about you a lot, but you're a follower. You really are.
You can interrogate me about Christmas.
You're doing what Joe, I went home at 31, but dude, it's enough already. Enough.
All right.
I got to make a break.
All right, that's fine.
Last year, I actually put stockings up. And it was this really nice environment in my apartment, hanging with my girl, having a great fucking time, and then I got to just pack up and go to Vietnam. Terrible.
Is your girl going to go back east for Christmas?
No, we're chilling.
So she's cool with that?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, then hey, you're doing what you're doing.
Yeah, her dad's out there.
All right.
Maybe, Joe, there'll be plenty of honey and ham to go around. They got ham in L.A. too.
They got ham in L.A.
Yeah.
All right.
I love that, too. People are just, sunny L.A., man, this is going to suck. Like it snows every year. It never does.
When's the last time
it snowed on Christmas, Joe?
Last year.
And you're always disappointed.
But I like it to be cold, and it just feels wintery, you know, whether there's snow or not.
I'm just gay. In a weather way, not in a
You're doing your
way.
Bit.
You like, I'm doing what?
You're doing your own bit now that you get mad about at me.
Well, that no,
you
that's
just
my,
did.
That's,
what are you a fag? You just did that bit at me. But
well, if you listen to the joke, Joe,
I try not to.
Then don't fucking reference it. I can't believe you let him make fun of your beard, and he's sitting here with his Chinese vintage Star Wars shirt on.
It's an awesome shirt,
huh? Yeah, if you're at a comic book festival.
Yeah. Do you think this dude is not going to think this shirt is cool? It's an awesome.
I'm gonna say
t-shirt.
How shallow you are. What's his name?
Michael.
He's right.
Yeah. Did you know that, Bill?
No, and I was hoping you'd forget, and then you'd send it back over to me. We have a funny little moment.
Well,
you had to be Mr. Smarty Pants over there.
I ruined the joke.
Michael, how far into the show are we? Evidently, every 25 minutes, we have to take a break. So our friend Danny Boy back in New York can edit this up.
We're about 16 minutes in.
16 All minutes right. in. I think it's been a strong 16. What do you think, Mike?
Absolutely. I mean, I just walked in here, but it's been pure
it's
gold
just,
since
absolutely.
I
like
Danny. Danny.
Sarcasm. I like that.
Danny, we miss you, man. Danny's not here, obviously, because we're in D.C.
And he was a little hurt, too, because when I went to, you know, set this thing up, I figured we're in D.C. I called Don Wicklund. I figured I'd call the guy with the moose and the fancy T-shirts.
Right.
And his Mad Max belt. He really... He is such a mess of a human being, Don Wicklund. I love him. He really is. He's a mess. Isn't he on, like, his 17th marriage?
Ah, Jesus.
You know, I love that guy.
I don't want to do this right now.
Why?
I don't know him as well as you do, so I'm afraid to...
We asked to get paid. He laughed in our face. And now you're going to show sympathy?
No, I'm just... I don't know him that well, and I don't want to get into his personal shit.
You know him well. You know him well enough to know that we don't, you know... We got to wait 9 years.
That he laughed at us to get our contract checks.
What are the odds we'll get paid for this show before 2010?
No way.
Yeah,
no way.
The merger.
No way.
The merger. Photosynthesis.
Barack will be out of office by the time we get paid for this. Which, by the way, I didn't... Everybody kept going, once January 20th comes, I didn't know what they were talking about. I literally thought that Barack was like, thanks, everybody, I won, and woke up the next day in the White House, like, moved his shit in the next day.
Oh, my God.
I didn't know Bush was president January.
Do you think Bush just stands there the night of the election with his bags packed?
Yeah. Yeah.
If they wrap this quick,
we can make the 11 p.m.
in, like, the waiting room of the Oval Office, just sitting there rubbing their hands together. How does it look? Like they're waiting for a kid to be born?
Yeah. Yeah.
Joe, did you vote?
No, I never vote.
Ugh.
I never vote. He still won. He won.
What, was that the guy? Can you put a... You got to swing it around. Put Melba on here. Here we go. Melba from the Improv. It was nice enough to give us a ride over here.
Hello.
Hi.
Okay. You have an amazing radio personality.
Yeah.
She's got a good voice,
she
too.
She does. You have a really nice voice.
Thank you.
I'm trying to give you, you're getting all defensive. Look at your arms are crossed.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
No.
You're, loosen up.
See,
just put...
if I raise my voice, then it won't be a great radio voice because I have a really naturally high voice.
Oh, is that what it is?
I'm trying to keep it radio.
Oh, you're trying to keep, you're going late night DJ on us. All right. So what do you think about Joe didn't, first of all, is she close enough to the mic or no?
She could be a little closer.
Okay.
There I am.
This is really just one of the most unprofessional shows we've had, but it's still
it's
a good
all right.
One.
Is it our fault?
No, it's not.
No, not at all.
It's Michael's fault.
Okay.
He should have said something.
Let's blame him.
I did not vote. What do you think of that?
I think everybody should vote right now. It's so pivotal. Like, you could have been a part of that big, what is it, like 18 to 29, you know, 31.
He's 31.
18 to 31 Youth of America vote.
But, you know, see, this is him holding on to his youth. He still goes home for Christmas. He's not registered to vote. He can't deal. He's wearing a Star Wars shirt.
I mean, the shirt.
Thank you. It's an awesome shirt.
You know, one of the improv games is you never say no. You always say yes, and you go with it. Or it just, that's what he does. That was a nice three-minute little rant we could have had. But, you know, thanks to you, you just got to be like, you know what? I think it's
I
a nice
like
shirt.
Shirt.
It's
and
with,
I, and
was
I
sewn well
home.
Together.
I believe in going home for
thank
Christmas.
Thank you.
Well, wow, my family comes up to see me all the time. This Thanksgiving, though.
How old are you?
I'm 29.
That's acceptable. 29 is acceptable. But you're going to start getting the questions. When are you getting married? What's going on?
I get those questions constantly. Constantly.
Why would you go back there for your own parental...
Because I love my parents, and I like seeing my aunts and uncles and my whole family at one time. It's a nice... It's just nice, dude.
Nice.
You're gonna
it's
go
a
home
nice
for
time.
The parental Guantanamo Bay and get waterboarded about how you're not married yet?
You deal with it.
Do you have an older brother or sister?
Yes, I do.
Like, usually they get the pressure that you don't have to get, right?
Well, they've given up on him.
Oh. Because, see, my sister, they're trying to make her have a baby. Me, they're just like, whatever. They don't care.
Oh, they don't care?
No.
Do you feel left out like Jan Brady?
No, I feel great.
You do?
They'll just keep attacking her.
Are you the middle child?
No, I'm the youngest.
Oh, you're the baby.
I'm the
I
baby.
Told you. I saw that about you.
Why?
You have that adorable youngest sibling vibe.
Oh, gosh.
You really do. You don't like compliments. Why are you looking away? Look
I
me in
do
the
like
eye
compliments.
As I tell you how adorable you are.
But I'm not like...
She's looking down. She can't do it, Joe.
Yeah. It's all right. Take it.
It's all right.
Thanks, Joe.
Take it. Take the fucking compliment.
Why the fuck would you think after right the second he gets elected? I wish they did it that way. That would be hilarious. It'd be
dumb.
Like a reality show.
It'll be like
I'm
a,
dumb,
I
Bill.
New
York I'm a fucking idiot. I don't know. I just never. It was just you know. There's just things you never think. You never stop and go. How does that actually work? How does that happen? I just never thought. It was just
oh, we talked
things.
About this the other day. What do you? The difference between actually being stupid and the difference. There's a fine line between being stupid and not giving a shit.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you're not a dumb guy. I mean, you're not a bright guy, Joe. You can't, like, go that far. But you're not a dumb guy. So, like, the reason why you didn't know that, that doesn't... A lot of people would think you're a fucking idiot because you don't know that. But I
no,
don't,
I
Joe.
Just don't care.
I take... Yes! You don't give a
I
shit.
I just don't
you
care.
You didn't vote, obviously.
I didn't vote, no. I don't...
Oh, somebody got a sticker the other day, huh?
I did.
Did you put that on your forehead walking around?
It was right on my chest on top of my Barack Obama shirt, yes.
Do you know I went down there and they said that they couldn't find my name? I wasn't registered?
So you're supposed to look that up.
Huh?
I wasn't registered where I was supposed to and had to look it up.
Oh, they tried that scam on you?
They did.
Did you think it was a racist thing?
No.
I felt it was reverse racism on me.
DC's in quadrants. So they just put me in the wrong quadrant.
Oh, they put you in the wrong quadrant?
Like northeast,
okay.
Northwest, southeast, southwest. They put me
who'd,
in northwest.
Who'd you vote for, McCain?
No, Obama. Yeah, McCain. I feel like Sarah Palin has some really bright ideas. She needs to bring that Alaska.
I felt
to the
bad.
I felt bad for McCain
at the end. I really felt sorry for the guy at
who?
The end. McCain. I felt sorry for him.
I felt sorry for
I would
him
have voted for
Mac
Obama. What'd you say?
When he said the Mac is back, I was like, you know he lost.
I would have,
yeah.
I would have voted for Obama had I voted, but I felt bad for McCain. I really, it was just sad. It was.
I didn't dislike him, but I mean, I'm not into the two parties, dude. I did a write-in. I wrote in Ron Paul because I overheard somebody say something in a bar about him that I liked, and that's how I casted my vote. You know what I like? I don't like to vote for either the Democratic or the Republican because then that gives me license to bitch no matter what happens because I didn't vote for him. And I always have the out.
Yeah.
You know, because I definitely lean left. So my brother will give me shit like, see, he's not doing nothing. Then I have the out to be like, I didn't vote for him.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, Carlin had that bit about about not voting and saying, you know, people say if you vote, you have the right to complain. And he's like, I think it's just the opposite. I had nothing to do with any of this, you know. That gives me full right to complain. I agree with that, 100%. But that's not why I don't vote. I just don't.
Do you know this?
I think
this
it's
is,
all
this
facade.
Is Joe, we're talking about Joe. Joe did a college gig in Mississippi. Okay, went to Mississippi, got on a plane, flew to Mississippi, drove or was picked up, was in Mississippi, left, and he still can't find it on a map. He couldn't find it on a map. I mean, he could if it was written big enough. And that's another one of those things where I really thought that meant you were a moron, and then I just realized that Joe not only does not give a shit about when the president moves into the White House, he also doesn't give a fuck about where Mississippi
he
is.
Yeah, it's but it's not like I don't give a fuck like fuck Mississippi. It's just like I don't like I can't remember capitals. I've been tested a million times through my, you know, through my schooling career or whatever that on capitals of countries and states and whatever. And I did well on the test because I memorized them. And then they're gone the next day.
The capital,
you know what
games,
I mean?
Like the capital song.
Yeah,
and stuff
math
like that.
Formulas. I can't remember shit. But I could tell. I was telling Bill this the other day. I could tell you. We should do this quiz right now. This would be fun. I could probably tell you the real name of the majority of popular rappers from the late '80s through the '90s, and where they were from. Like seriously, quiz me.
That is interesting.
Quiz me.
Somebody, nobody gives a shit.
Ice-T, Tracy Morrow is his real name. He was born in New Jersey.
The Puerto Rican fat guy in the Fat Boys.
Hold on a second. But he grew up in South Central Los Angeles.
Why would you know that?
Because I was a huge rap fan. Ask me another one.
I told you the fat Puerto Rican guy.
I wasn't into the Fat Boys, and they were
See?
More.
Bam!
Come on.
All right, end.
No, no.
You're just as dumb.
Come
they're
on.
Like a group. It's not like a rapper.
Yeah, ask me what are we one. Up to here with like minutes here? Is it almost up to 25?
Bill, I think we're about.
Yeah, right. He's supposed to do the sign.
All right, he didn't know.
He was the other guy.
Well, right. At some point.
All right, fine.
Joe, nobody cares.
No, you don't care. That's
the
rude.
Same way you don't care. Well, I asked you she asked you one. You said I could name most of them.
No, yeah, and I said late 80s into the 90s. The Fat Boys are early 80s.
No, they're not. They're not. They are not. They're not early 80s. Run
they're
DMC.
About mid-80s, because they had those movies going into the 90s.
Yeah, they had movies. I mean, they're big enough.
Disorderly,
stars.
It was
a crossover.
Like
it's a funny bit to pair up with me being dumb and not giving a shit. It's just, can we just finish it?
Well, can you
we
put
do a
some
couple?
Energy into it, Joe?
I am. We're doing the fucking thing. You're talking about improv, not saying no, always saying yes. You just said...
Clarence. And he's from New Brunswick, New Jersey. Bill. That's what you were doing, Joe. With
something. I hate when you do this. I hate when you think something's not funny and you just stomp on it, dude.
Joe, you've stomped on like three things in the first 25 minutes that I had.
I haven't stomped on anything. You're the one saying improv. Let's say yes.
Tell you something, Joe. You know what I was thinking? That T-shirt that you have with the Chinese writing on. You ever think like the kid in the sweatshop labor was like so tired he actually started sewing in his own language?
Yeah. That's what it is, Bill. Ask me another rapper. Is
Joe,
that all staying in?
We got it, yeah. Joe, that's the show, man. We fucking
right.
argue.
This show is so, it's lousy so far today.
You know
all
what?
Right.
Now you're going to pout? You're going to take your ball
No, I'm not
home.
Pouting.
He's
I'm
pouting.
Not.
You're pouting.
I'm not pouting. It's just, we're so disjointed. That's all.
Joe,
it feels
this is one of the reoccurring problems that we've had on the show. Okay, aside from me being a little cunty, has been that you sometimes will sort of take it into an AM radio talk show
Bill.
Vibe.
It, but Bill, you're not giving it 10 seconds to develop. You immediately are stomping on something and not giving it a chance to go anywhere. And you just said 5 minutes ago that you say yes to improv, not no. You don't shut it down. And I.
But if it's bombing.
It wasn't bombing.
Joe, I could hear truckers driving
Christ,
off the
Bill.
Road as we were doing that.
Jesus Christ.
All right, listen.
All right,
let's
do everything you want to do. You control
no,
everything.
No, you know what? We will come back with Joe when we come back from the go break. Ahead. Joe DeRosa and his hilarious bit of how he can name most of the rappers'
names. It was just
to
prove the
point. Shut your mouth. You're listening to Uninformed. Keep it here.
It's Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa.
This is Sirius Speedway with Dave Moody.
Mike Wallace.
I'm working on things from a personal side of things. I'm trying to find a sponsor that Mike Wallace can race next year. The indications have been given to me by Germain Racing that if we don't have a sponsor, I won't race for them. They've got some other things on the hook or some other people bringing some money that are, you know, they're going to do some things with it appears.
Sirius Speedway, weekdays 3 to 7 Eastern on Sirius NASCAR Radio 128. Now part of the best of Sirius.
A great number of our immune system cells are in our digestive tract. Friendly bacteria help keep these cells healthy and fend off bad bacteria. Probiotics replenish the friendly bacteria, often lost due to everyday stress, antibiotics, x-rays, oral contraceptives, and poor dietary habits. They also help reduce intestinal distress, such as heartburn and bloating. Dr. O'Hara's Probiotics 12 Plus is one of the world's leading brands of probiotics. Dr. O'Hara's Probiotics 12 strains of bacteria protects our immune system so that we are less likely to get frequent colds or flu. Fermented for 3 years, Dr. O'Hara's Probiotics 12 Plus capsules do not need refrigeration and are the perfect traveling companion. Dr. O'Hara's Probiotics 12 Plus is available at Vitamin Shop and other fine health food stores nationwide, or order online at probiotics12.com. Dr. O'Hara's Probiotics 12 Plus. Get it today.
This product has not been evaluated by the FDA and is not intended to treat, cure, or prevent any disease. Results may vary.
Stuck in a dead-end job? Your career just not going anywhere? CUNET, the college and university network, understands. So CUNET makes you this promise. Give us a call, and we'll help you pinpoint your interest, locate schools that meet your needs, and get your career back on track in just minutes. CUNET helps you take that first step towards furthering your education and career. CUNET will search thousands of schools with programs ranging from certificates and trade programs to doctorate programs. Then, CUNET puts that school in touch with you. CUNET's service is always free. Take the first step toward getting your life and your career moving forward, all in one simple, easy step. Pick up the phone and call us in the next 30 minutes. Operators are standing by. Don't put your life on hold any longer. Call CUNET at 800-719-0442. That's 800-719-0442. CUNET advisors are waiting to take your call. 800-719-0442.
Get the stinky dog away from me.
Petey stopped eating. All his hair fell out.
Mounds and mounds of fur.
Our hairballs have hairballs.
Bad breath and bad gas.
Chew himself raw.
Sticky, gooey, smelly.
She scratched incessantly.
At least $5,000 in vet bills.
I heard about Dynavite on this radio station.
I just called my wife. I said, dear, you gotta check out Dynavite.
I logged on to DINOVITE.com.
The omega-3 fatty acids, zinc, probiotics.
There's flaxseed oil.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
6 days later, my dog's ear problems were cured.
The shedding has stopped and the itching has stopped.
His breath was better. His gas was better.
Tons of energy. No more bad smell.
She has gotten this puppy look. Her coat has sheen.
Everything we tried failed except the Dynavite.
My vet was completely blown away.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
Hi, this is Big A, and when I need an XM radio or accessories, I visit myradio.com. That's 866, I need XM, or visit myradio.com.
You got to lie to the baby. Oh, you got to lie to the baby. Oh, you got to lie to the baby. Lie to the baby, move on. Woo!
All right, what's up? We're back on Uninformed. I think it's been a good show so far. I got a little testy before that last break.
Can we just do one more rapper?
Absolutely, but so we can at least we're gonna at least hype what we got going on today. Our guest today is our most unreal guest so far. We actually have Joe Perry from Aerosmith.
Yes,
is going to be calling in the show here at the top of the hour. I guess it's going to be in like another 10 minutes. I don't know how the hell they're going to edit this, but isn't that a great intro? Yeah, we have Joe Perry from Aerosmith who's going to be informing us.
He'll be here. We're very excited about it, and we're also going to talk about our fantasies of what it's like to be a rock star, because that's the whole premise of the show, is that we talk uneducatedly, if that's even a word, about a subject, and then our expert comes on and shows how dumb we are. So today, we are going to try to talk about what we think it's like to be a rock and roll legend, and then Joe will come on and tell us what it's really like. And maybe we'll be right, maybe we'll be wrong. Who knows,
Bill? And that's where the excitement is.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
So, Joe, what's the real name of
Just one
Heavy
more.
D?
I don't know, Heavy D. I didn't listen to Heavy D.
Every guy I bring up. I know
you're bringing up the shittiest rappers of all time.
This is the thing, Joe. This is what I'm bringing up. I'm bringing up the guys who actually crossed over into my world, which means they were hugely famous because I wasn't listening to that stuff.
That's why I was directing the bit towards her, because she will be able, she'll come up with the, I have a feeling she's going to know the people that I was into.
Joe, Jesus Christ. I mean, I'm not in 100% into hair metal, but, you know, I know the fucking guy from White Lion Guitar. His name was Vinny something. He's from Long Island.
Let her ask me one more, and then over.
Ask him one more.
Okay.
Please pick one that he doesn't know.
That he won't know.
Any day now.
What about Flavor Flav?
Flavor Flav's real name is William, I believe, Horton.
Wow.
And he is from, I think he's from Staten Island in New York. I know he's from New York City, one of the boroughs, but I think it's Staten Island.
Did you just by yourself or with a group of people? Like, you all just, like, did this?
No, I just was so obsessed with rap music when I was a kid. I'd read, like, any group I was into, N.W.A., for instance, Ice Cube, O'Shea Jackson, Eazy-E, Eric Wright, Dr. Dre, Andre Young, Lorenzo Parliament, I think, is MC Ren.
Okay.
You know, I just knew it all. I would read the liner notes. I'd read all the shit. I just knew everything. Because I cared about it. I didn't care about fucking remembering what the capital of Oklahoma is. Still couldn't. Oklahoma City, maybe? Is that what the capital is? Do you know, Bill? Why are you not speaking right
I'm
now?
I'm just letting you go with your bit. It's going to go.
Bill, it's not a bit. It was...
What is going on with the phones? Jesus. People walking in and out.
Is that going to be on the air?
Do you have
noises?
Any idea how huge this radio show is that you're walking? We have at least 18 listeners.
Is that going to be on the air, those phone noises?
I imagine it is, Joe.
I mean, if we could hear it, they could hear
it,
right?
They could hear it. Right, they're having like a conversation over here. What's going on? Let's just...
I thought we were going to come to the headquarters.
They're talking about
You work here at the XM?
I do.
You look like a UFC guy. You used to fight or something?
No, Tank Abbott.
Tank Abbott, yeah.
And when I used to have a goatee, people used to say that.
I thought you were going to say you were related to him. You're not?
No.
And what are you talking to Michael about?
Phone. I just want to make sure you guys are taking care of phone.
Oh, when the phone comes in? Okay. We're just going to work that out. Over there in the corner.
This is a train wreck today, dude.
Yeah. How many more, like, I'm not trying to be a dick or anything, but how many more people are just going to kind of come walking in and out in the middle?
This is the last one.
Okay.
I'm a big fan, by the way, so I'll enjoy that.
Oh. Well, okay. Well, I'm glad you're enjoying it. We're taping a show right now that's going to go out.
That's what I do when I'm a fan of things.
You just sort of burst in on it?
Yeah.
Just sort of walk in and just sit there
awkwardly. I'm a big fan. Went to the Bad Religion show. Took a piss right in the front of the fucking stage. It's a show. Am I really into their shit?
They were halfway through the set and you came in and started adjusting the microphone levels.
Jumped on stage.
Just going to make sure the microphones are okay.
Pulled the bass player off the fucking stage in the middle of their closer. Yeah, I'm a big fan.
I'm a big fan. I barge right in. Didn't think I'd want to check the phones before the show started, but what exactly do you have to? Are the phones going to be okay? Is it going to be okay?
Hopefully.
Wow.
As long as I'm here.
So these are the questions we've asked.
I'd like to.
Can we get paid? Good luck with that.
Yeah. Are the phones okay? Hopefully.
Hopefully.
Bill, can I tell you a story about a boy that had a dream?
A dream of what, Joe? Having a radio show?
A dream that he had a radio show, and he did his radio show with a good friend of his. In a little studio in New York, and it went pretty well. And he thought, one day, maybe we'll get to do the show from the big studio in D.C. And that's where you really get the king
get the
shit
real,
treatment.
Yeah, that's right. You got the professional level.
Yeah, and you show up, and they go, it's not really the king shit treatment. We're going to take the king out of that phrase, and it's just going to be the shit
basement.
Treatment.
All right, well,
people walking
you.
In
thank
and
you
out.
For coming in. Okay.
Thank you.
Can we hang the do not disturb sign on the outside there? Just, you know?
Yeah, just no answer to that question.
I feel like I'm auditioning to have a radio show.
I feel like we're on the Gong Show right now.
All right, well, let me ask you this, Joe. What do you feel? What do you feel right now? What do you feel about? Oh, hey, look at it. I have a USA Today, Joe, right here. This is Mississippi. This is where you went.
I got you.
You landed right there, Joe.
Awesome.
Okay. completely. Doesn't give
this
a fuck.
This is what I feel.
Dude,
I think
the stock market go down again. You know, there's a real fucking chance, Joe. By the time this show comes out, like this country won't exist anymore.
All right.
How much further down can it go?
Let's get to right now. Let's save that for the third hour and get to us talking about being a rock star, which is why I wanted to do that music bit.
Well, Joe, this is the thing. When Joe Perry calls in, I don't want to be asking him, you know, would you like to have two-on-ones? I want to have some sort of like...
No, we don't. We're just going to say in our discussions, we imagine this. Is that true or not? Let's give him something to be an expert on today. I mean, that's the whole point.
Okay.
You know? What do you think? I mean, what is your honest...
I think I know what it's like to be a rock star. I watched enough of those behind the musics.
Yeah, that's the problem. The sort of curtain's been taken away, yeah. And you kind of...
And they already told their stories.
But, I mean, you know the one difference between rock star and comedian? Like, the major, major difference besides the money and the respect...
There's some weird-ass looking people here at fucking XM.
Besides the money and the women and all that stuff, the major difference, I thought, between being a rock and roll whatever and a comedian is that it seems like there's less... It's more carefree as a rock star. It seems as a comedian, there is always that stress of like, I have to get my bookings taken care of. I have to make sure I'm on the road. I have to make sure I can pay my bills.
Right.
And I can't be a complete alcoholic and a cokehead because I got to get all the shit done. And it seems like a lot of musicians, that for some reason, don't have that pressure because your label is setting up the tour and we're going to... I mean, dude, musicians...
Yeah, that's why they always end up having no money, Joe, because everyone else takes care of the shit. And then when they come home off a tour, they get a check for like 14 bucks. Because the tour, in quotes, pays for everything, and the artist is the tour. Which is why I like being a comedian. I got hiccups. Why did we eat Wendy's before we did this, Joe?
I don't know. It's another thing. Playing a band, you can eat Wendy's before you go on
Dude,
stage.
You know
how hard is it to just stand there with a bass guitar?
It is difficult. Because you know what? Because you have to perform. You want to talk about us self-sabotage. Last night, I had to write a sketch for a show that I'm trying to get on the air. You want to write on the show. We knew we had to do the work, and what did we do instead?
We drank, and then we did the work.
We didn't, Joe. We drank till 3 in the morning. And I actually looked at my notes this morning when I had to write that sketch. It made absolutely no fucking sense.
I knew it wasn't going to, which is why I said, let's open Microsoft Word and listen to what I'm saying, and let's type out these notes. And you were like, nah, I'm good. We're fine
yeah,
like
Joe, this
is
because you threw fucking 12 drinks down my throat.
I didn't throw them down your throat.
I was the one who was like, dude, let's go home and let's write this thing. You go, come on, dude, let's have one. The hackiest thing to ever say.
And then
say
you
in a bar.
Said, let's have one more.
That's what happened. That's why I didn't want to go. I didn't want to go.
It's a 50-50 thing here. That's all I'm saying.
No, it isn't. I was the guy saying, let's stay clean.
Fuck that.
I was the guy saying,
fuck
I was the guy
that.
Saying, let's call a cab.
And I was the guy drunk going, here's how we need to take care of this right now. And you said no. So it's a 50-50 split, dude. We both tried to act responsibly at different times, and the other one blew it off. And whatever.
That makes no sense whatsoever.
Ah, Bill. How come every time I make a point against you, it makes no sense
because,
whatsoever?
Joe, my point was, let's stay sober and let's get this thing done. And your point is, well, after we both got shit-faced, I made a responsible move.
Yeah, I was saying, look, here, let's take these notes down in Microsoft Word. It'll make more sense
right,
for you. And
yeah.
You said no.
I was nodding off on heroin, and that's when I said, hey, let's wait a half hour to go swimming. And, you know, let's wait till we puke up this heroin before we go
swimming.
You want me to
go write the sketch today the way I thought we could have written it last night and send it to you? Because I'll do that. And then you could... I remember,
Joe, you remember the part last night when
about.
We were supposed to be writing the sketch and you fell asleep?
No, you were on the phone for a half an hour with somebody and I fell asleep.
I wasn't on the phone for a half an hour. That was your fucking brain telling you it was a half an hour. That was the whiskey, Joe. I was on the phone for like 5 minutes.
Bill, it wasn't 5 minutes, bro. Because you called Nia and then you were talking to one of your buddies and it was like...
No, it wasn't.
Bill, trust me, you were on the phone for a long time, man. And then you even said, you go, look, I really got to go. Like, I have my friend here, and, like, we're talking.
Oh, is that what I said?
Yes.
And did I say, you know, and Joe's so right because Joe just said it was 30 minutes?
No,
I like
no.
how when you
no,
tell the you story, didn't... I agree with you in the story.
No, I didn't say anything. I didn't give you shit for being on the phone. You just were like, dude, I remember at the end of the conversation, you go,
Joe, you don't remember, and I don't remember because we were shit-faced.
Bill.
That's what, dude, you look like a guy at a bus station, the way you were fucking sleeping on the couch.
I remember.
He was doing that shit, you know, you failed, like the weight of your head. You were doing that.
Listen to me. Listen to me. You can say that, and that's fine, and
oh,
I will
you.
Give you
thank
that.
Thank you for giving me...
I will
you.
Give you that, but
what,
don't try to put
day?
More blame on me that we ended up drunk last night. That's not fair. That's not fair. I said, let's have one. I would have left
I'm putting,
after one.
You know what? I'm
you
taking
said,
49% of this, Joe.
Fuck I'll, that. No. No.
No. It's
be,
not fuck
no.
that.
Man
it's
up and take half the blame. You didn't have to... I didn't twist your arm. You didn't have to have the drink.
I'm not...
And you said,
I'm
let's have more. And then you wanted to do the third one. That was
Joe,
your idea.
Joe, speaking of rock bands... one guy, whenever one guy sobers up and the other guys aren't, they can't fucking hang out together because they're going to get sucked down into it. That's why Aerosmith, when they all got clean together. And that's what I was trying to do with you. I was trying to get clean, man, so we could write that sketch. And you're like, dude, let's go to the bar and have one, knowing full well that we, the only people, Apaches are the only people more weak with alcohol than you and me.
If I was so drunk.
You got Native American in you, Joe.
I can tell you right now.
Joe is a gutter drunk. I'm gonna buy you a fucking raincoat.
Oh, please.
That's what you need.
I could tell you right now like the Jack sketch Klugman. Exactly that you couldn't remember this morning and all that. I could tell you exactly what it was from beginning to end and what the wrap up of it was, the button as you called it, because you had to explain to me what that term meant last night because I didn't know what it meant, and how the guys in the sketch died and all that.
I know,
I could tell you all that.
But the bottom line is at the end of the fucking night, it wasn't done.
And I was standing over your shoulder going, here's what
because
we need to do. And you
we
told me,
drinking.
Forget it. You
because
told me
we
you didn't
drinking.
Want to. You
because
said you
I
want...
was ready to pass out because well, we were drunk, Joe. Which is why
deal.
I was saying we shouldn't drink.
All right. You shouldn't. I was fine. I was ready to work.
Joe, you fucking passed out. You ordered room service.
You ordered room service. You ate some pizza.
Because we were shit-faced. That's what we were doing together. We were fucking drunk and we didn't write. And somehow, you're sitting there acting like when you're shit-faced, yeah, man, like you're Ernest Hemingway.
No, I'm
you're not,
not
Joe.
I'm just
you're
saying.
You're a fucking
I'm
gutter
saying
drunk.
I'm saying I dealt with the booze and I said I was ready to write and you said no, I'll do it later. And I said fine, but I was ready
Steven
to do
Tyler
the work.
Steven Tyler and Joe Perry used to go at it like this?
Yeah.
I bet they did.
Probably. Let's go write the sketch today after this. We'll
Joe,
go back.
Too, I had to turn it in this morning. I did. I did
you
it this
You told me
morning.
You had to rework on it, you said. You go, I got to fix it, and I got to change shit. So
well,
let's
no,
go change
I,
shit.
I sent is this interesting to anybody, other than that we're just fucking yelling at each other?
No.
All right, so we are... Joe, all I'm saying, Joe, is we're going to fucking write. Let's not get shit-faced. I don't
I
think I'm being crazy.
That. I don't think you're
being
crazy.
Crazy.
I just got defensive when you were trying to make it sound like I was more at fault. I wasn't more at fault. That was a 50-50 venture last night.
Go fuck yourself, man. Go fuck yourself with that. That's all I'm saying. That's my point. That's my point.
Yeah, no, you're trying to get me pissed off.
No,
I,
no,
I
Joe,
see exactly
I mean,
what you're doing.
Joe, you know what it is, Joe? When somebody goes, hey, let's do the right thing, and the other guy goes, no, let's do the wrong thing. Come on, let's do one thing. I mean, Joe, can you at least say that you took the first step into hell last night? That you
Bill,
at least...
I said I'd like to have a beer to unwind, and we had a beer, and then you
That's
said, let's
you
have
said
another
so
one.
Not yes, what I you did. Said. Do you see how you just frame that, Joe? You're like, I said, hey, let's have a beer so we can unwind. If you ever said that to me, Joe, I would slap you with the nearest blunt object because you don't talk like that.
Remember.
You, said, you laughed. You had that fucking look in your eye. You said, come on, Bill. Ah, that's that one. You did that.
You said, do you want to, I said, let's get a beer. And you go, you really want to have a drink? And I go, I'd like to have one.
No, you didn't, Joe.
That's
you know
exactly
what, you look like?
What
I
said.
Always, I always use Goodfellas as a reference. You were like fucking De Niro after they knocked off that thing. You're like, come here, you. Come here, you. That was your vibe. And that's when I started laughing, knowing that what we were doing was fucking stupid. That was the silent conversation that we had. But so, all I'm saying is, Joe, I'll take 49.9% of that. But, dude, you were the fucking jack-off, knowing that we're both a couple of drunks who said, let's go up to the bar, like we weren't going to have 50 after that. And you weren't going to nod off with French fries in your fucking mouth 3 hours later in my room. How gay is my room, by the way?
It's
because
awesome.
We're in D.C., they have it. It looks like it's like this little mini Oval Office, and they have like this bookcase. I don't know if you saw that with all these great books in there, but you can't get to them. They're like behind the glass. So like, I don't know what that's supposed to do.
It's
in case like somebody from
it's
room
like
service
legal.
Comes in, yeah, I'm supposed to have the illusion like I've read all these books.
This is. I hear what you're saying, and this is I guess what I'm a little upset about is I wanted to help you with it. And I did feel last night that I was trying to put forth the effort to help you with it. I know we shouldn't have had some drinks first. But when all was said and done, and I was in your room and tipsy, I was still standing there like, hey, man,
yeah,
I got...
You were drunk. You were drunk writing a sketch, Joe. How do you think that's going to go? And I was drunk listening to you.
But you wrote the sketch. You did the sketch that I...
No, I wrote it this... Dude, I had to fix it, Joe. And I'm not saying, dude, we were both fucking drunk. I'm saying I don't want to be drunk and write sketches with you, Joe. Why can't you just
That's
go along
fine.
With that?
Fine. I'm fine with not being drunk, but I feel like
you
I'm...
You put your eyebrows down, Joe.
I feel like that I'm somehow cut out of the process now of the creation of the sketch where I don't feel like I was. Like, I came up with the premise of what you went with,
no.
and then you
Joe,
changed
no, I'm not,
the ending.
Joe, I'm not... Relax, dude. You're going to get credit. What do you think, I'm Led Zeppelin
credit.
Over here, Joe?
I just want the job,
you think
Bill.
I'm Led Zeppelin? I'm not saying you're not...
Job. I just want the writing job of
okay.
the fucking show.
Well, that was the point of the whole story, Joe. I'm trying to get this fucking thing on the air. I got just as much self-sabotage as you do. Think about that, Joe. I want to get a show on the air. You want to write on the show. We have a sketch to write, so we go drink.
I'm really depressed.
That is the stupidest fucking thing we could have done.
I'm really depressed. I'm really depressed
about it.
Right
fine,
now.
Fine. We're getting to the
I'm
real
depressed
feelings.
About that. I'm depressed at the way this whole thing has gone today. The whole treatment of XM with us today. I'm really bummed out about it, man. This whole thing has been a fucking train wreck.
What did you think was going to happen when you came in? Did you think that there was going to be an excitement? Oh, the uninformed guys are here?
Oh, they're finally. Well, I just thought that people wouldn't be coming in and out of the room and just having blatant conversations during the radio show.
Joe,
at least
the fact
that much.
The fact that we have to wait 6 months for checks, didn't that kind of give
We're
you
going
a
to payroll today. We're going up to payroll today and asking for our
is
checks.
There, can we have wireless mics and can we go up to payroll today and try to get paid?
Yeah, can you do that?
We'll be back with Uninformed.
Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa. Hi, kids. Did you miss today's Opie and Anthony show? Don't cry. Don't cry. It's going to be okay. Do you want to listen to Opie and Anthony shows wherever you go? Shut up! Shut up! Just go to audible.com. Shows are posted every single day for you to download, or you can browse their massive library for your favorite Opie and Anthony broadcast. Or if that's too complicated, you can go to opieandanthony.com and there's links every single day to a fresh new broadcast that you can download.
Looking to make the most of your holiday budget this year? Sirius and XM can make a little money go a long way. With tons of great new programming choices and radios from just $19.99, it's the perfect gift for anyone on your list. Your brother, the comedian, your sports fanatic dad, or cooking and crafts-loving mom. Sirius XM gives them all front-row seats to the most exclusive, star-studded radio entertainment anywhere. Get your holiday shopping out of the way now and take advantage of great subscriber deals on holiday gift packages and great radios like the portable Stiletto or new XMP3. Just call 866-9-SIRI-XM. That's 866-9-SIRI-XM. Or visit Sirius.com/New Radio or XMRadio.com/New Radio for complete details. So this year, make the most of your holiday budget and let Sirius and XM make your money go a lot further. Everything worth listening to is now on Sirius and XM.
I was driving my rig down the interstate. Had an on-time bonus, couldn't afford to be late. So to save on fuel, save time and cash, I fly by the scale house, move on past with PrePass.
PrePass.
It's a bypass system, first of its kind. Checks my weight and my docks driving 65. Then a green light flashes up on my dash. And while the other rigs stop, I just move on past with PrePass.
PrePass.
With your good driving record, PrePass can save you time and money on every haul. Highway sensors check your weight and certifications as you drive highway speed. If everything checks, a green light on your dash says drive on by. Try PrePass free. We guarantee you'll want it along on every haul. Visit PrePass.com/XM or call 888-559-PASS and mention XM to try PrePass free. That's PrePass.com/XM or 888-559-PASS.
And now, another reason to switch to Geico.
You have better things to think about than car insurance. You know, like where your 4-year-old hid your cell phone, or why your dog doesn't appreciate everything you do for him. Yeah, you've got a lot to think about. So Geico invented Geico.com. It makes doing everything from updating your policy to reporting a claim fast, easy, a no-brainer. Hey, with all you've got on the brain, it's the least we could do.
For a free rate quote, visit Geico.com or call 1-800-947-AUTO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Business owners, AmeriMerchant can provide your business up to $200,000 in working capital in 7 days or less without the hassle of a bank. And unlike a bank, we have a 90% approval rate. Turn your future credit sales from your customers into fast cash. You can use the money for anything you choose, such as expansion, marketing, purchasing inventory, paying off debt, buying out investors or partners, acquiring other business. Call 877-469-6520. AmeriMerchant offers you a no-hassle application with simple, easy steps. We offer multiple cash advance programs that can get your business up to $200,000 right away. With approvals as fast as 24 hours, pay back with your future credit card transactions from your customers. If you have $5,000 per month in credit card sales from your customers, you may qualify. Call AmeriMerchant now to find out how much you may qualify for today. Call 877-469-6520. That's 877-469-6520. That's 1-877-469-6520.
The virus is an XM channel which may contain explicit language. Channel blocking is available by calling 1-800-XM-RADIO or an XM Canada 877-438-9677.
this.
All right, hey, this is we're back, Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa here on the Uninformed Radio Show. We're very happy to have our next guest, which is easily by far our greatest guest that we've had so far, Mr. Joe Perry from Aerosmith. Joe, what's up?
Hey, how you doing?
We're doing good. We just had a big battle. I don't know if you were listening to that. Me and Joe DeRosa, we were supposed to write a sketch last night for a TV show, and instead of doing that, we decided that the better move was to get shit-faced first.
Yeah.
Before we did it.
That sounds like it was an inevitable thing.
Yeah. We took the behind the music road.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, it's actually just about 10% of inspiration, and the rest of it's getting yourself nailed down in front of the typewriter or the microphone or whatever, you know.
Yeah, I think it was more fear of success and just not wanting to do it. So we decided that rather than try to make our dream come true, we'd try to down a bottle of Johnny Black and somehow.
Yeah.
That'll work.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Hey, so you said you weren't in the best mood today. What's going on?
I don't know. It's kind of gloomy out, and the reality of all the world leaders just lining up, getting ready to take their shot at our new president. I just read some of the headlines, and I too have to. I'm in the process of trying to get inspired to write some music, and it's tough. It's tough trying to make something out of nothing.
It's the worst.
You know exactly what I'm talking about. You stand there, and it's like it's you and the microphone, or it's you and I guess it's a computer. You sit behind the computer and type.
How do you go about like when you're writing a new album? I mean, what is that like?
Well,
that's
what I'm doing. I'm trying to get try not to listen to what else is out there. You know what I mean? I don't want to be inspired by it, but it's good that I see there's a lot of rock and roll out there. There's AC/DC's coming out with a new record, and Metallica, and I don't have too much hope for the Guns N' Roses record. I mean, they've been talking about that coming out for 14 years, so.
What's the longest it's taken you to put something out?
Well, it takes. Well, so this one, I mean, this record, I don't think we've put out a studio album for 5 or 6 years.
Right.
So we've started it and stopped it and gone on the road, not gone on the road, then tried to start it again, and so this one's taken a while. But usually, I mean, when we were like in the 90s, we had a pretty much of a system where we'd work about almost down to the day. It would be 3 months. You know what I mean? We'd work a little bit, get some outlines for some songs, and then we'd all get together and pound.
Do you go into that like that whole 3 month process with like dread? Are you looking at that like, God, I can't wait to get through this, or do you actually enjoy it?
No, once you get into it, it's good. It's because you see progress. But it's at this point, we're still at the point of we've been kind of, everybody's been off, screwing off for the past year, and it's really hard getting going again. It's like you gotta climb yourself into that place where you start to get inspired. So I have a guitar pretty much within reach anywhere, and I have a mini disc player or a recorder, and I always have that, and then like riffs start popping out, songs lyrics start popping out, and
so do you that like at like the breakfast table? You'll be eating like Fruit Loops, and all of a sudden like
anytime, anything. I could be watching TV. I could be, I don't know. I haven't seen. I have breakfast around 2. whatever.
Is that what time a rock star eats breakfast?
And that's if I'm hungry anyway. But it can be any time, and I just wander around, kind of like something pops in my head, I'd lay it down on the mini disc player, then I'd take that down into the studio and then try and build something out of it. And I make myself do it. I have to do it. Some days I'll say, look, you're going to, you know, one way or another, you're going to write a song. It may suck, and chances are it will, but at least I'll be done with it. And at least, and you kind of keep doing that. And after a while, you kind of get into the groove, and, you know, then the stuff that you're coming up with is like a lot better than the first stuff. You know what
right.
I mean? So that's kind of how it works. And I mean, that's it, the day to day thing. And
so today's one of those days you're just not feeling it.
Well, right now I'm doing an interview with some guys that are gonna like I said, that are gonna raise my mood at least 50%.
We can do that.
And then I'll go back downstairs with my engineer, and we're gonna like pound a few out, you know, and turn the guitar up loud and let it rip, you know.
How different is the process now? I mean, was it I'm imagining it was a whole different ball game when you guys were a young new band, you know what I mean, in the early days, writing a new record, right? I mean, was it more like all of you guys in a room at that time?
Not, you know what, we really, once we started the format, I mean, Steven and I have always, you know, from the time we wrote our first song together, it's, you know, we've always had a kind of a teamwork thing, and he would play drums, I'd play guitar. And that's what we were doing. He was over here yesterday. He was still doing the same thing, and and that works. And then the other guys, you know, we work with each other, and some of them, you know, everybody will have different stuff, and we'll kind of like work together in different formats, and then we'll all get together in a room and start pounding the songs down and sometimes with a producer and that's pretty much the same as it's been when we first did it, you know, I mean, but back then it was more to write songs that we were going to play at the clubs, you know, we were going to play
right.
live because they, you know, we didn't have a record deal. And
how long did it take you before you didn't suck at guitar? You know what I mean? Because I gotta admit, like, I've started to play in the last year and a half, and I finally got to the point where I could kind of stand up and play a song, and I looked at myself in the mirror holding a guitar, and I almost, like, I passed out how much of a fucking nerd I looked like. I just, like, did you, like, how long did it take before you actually looked cool playing a guitar?
There's still that danger of not. You know, it's
what's the worst thing you've ever seen film of you doing something on stage that you look back on and was like, oh my God, did I really do that?
I don't know. There were some times when we would do, we would be off the road for months, and then we'd get some gig somewhere, and we just, you know, weren't in shape, and the band wasn't playing good, you know, because we wouldn't rehearse. And there were a few times like that in the 70s when it was like, you know, those gigs were better for God. You know?
Did you feel like hiding behind your amp at that point, or you just say to hell with it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you just plow through it. And if the audience, you know, usually the audience doesn't know notice that much of a difference, because, you know, you kind of raise your average after a while. You know what I mean? And that's really what where you start getting that professional thing where you really, where the show goes, must go on, and you kind of like, you know, you basically raise the average. So even if you're having a bad night for yourself, it still might not be that bad overall when, you know, compared to what the audience is.
Hey, how does that work if, like, the rest of the band is on and you're not on?
I look at Brad and I go, help me out, brother.
Is that just a look at this point and he knows?
No, you know what? He just has to listen. You know what I mean? It's like when we're listening to each other play, and it's that kind of a thing.
Does he give you shit afterwards on the bus?
Not at all.
Not at all.
No, we're too close to that. That's like,
well, yeah, I meant more like breaking balls. I didn't.
Everybody has a bad night. You know what I mean? And once in a while, you know, yeah, we'll, you know, if it's because of somebody like really screwing up because they're indulging themselves. You know, and then it shows. That's one thing. But most of the time, I mean, we're pretty professional. professional about that. I mean, we really want to put on a good show, and sometimes you just don't have a great night. You know what I mean? Sometimes you get your hand on the ball and it slips out of your fingers. What
right.
do you do?
Well, I got to tell you, that night we saw you a couple years ago. We saw you in Jones Beach with Motley Crue.
Yeah.
You know, to help you get inspired. And it was like I had probably last time I'd seen you guys before that was. I saw you at the old Boston Garden New Year's Eve show with Skid Row. I don't know if you remember that one.
Wow.
And you guys were even better like 20 years later. I couldn't believe it. Like I went out there and like you guys still have that thing where you watch them as a band and you still got that like just sitting in the audience. She's like, I wish I could do that.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Thanks a lot.
So I'll take credit for anything you write today.
It's nice.
Thanks. Okay, good. That's good.
It's nice to hear too.
Joe, you really sound like you're struggling today, man. Like you just really, it really sounds like I can't believe like how overcast is it up there. It just really seems like there's a lot of rubbing of your brow. Like
I'm trying to. I'll probably drink about 2 gallons of coffee before we're done, and I get downstairs and like turn everything really loud, and that tends to work.
Do you wear earplugs or anything like that? Or you just how do you guys do that, man? I play drums for like 2 years.
They're men.
They got
I would not recommend drummers to not wear something because the drums, as it turns out, are drummers suffer a lot more than guitar players. The drums are really loud. It's almost like a gunshot, you know, that snare drum and the cymbals. It's really loud. And guitar, you can just kind of, all you got to do is move over 3 feet and you're not standing in front of the amp, you know. So
all right.
Kind of pick your spot. And once in a while, you want to stand in front of your amp and it sounds really good. And then you can move over and it isn't quite as abusive, but man, when you're sitting there right next to that snare drum, there's nothing you can do about it. So, drummers really take it, man. And you got to wear something, I think.
How many guitars you got at this point? 9,000.
Bunch, a lot.
That was nice to hear that there's like an actual camaraderie amongst musicians, like when you were saying. You know, if you have everybody's got a bad night, and it's like, does he break your balls? And you're like, nah, man, we're close. Because that is the exact opposite of the behavior on this radio show and with comedians.
Yeah, I don't know if you listened to it. We were pretty much trashing each other. You know what we need to do? Maybe we need to get, like, some sort of therapist for this show. Like, I've seen, like, Aerosmith did that. Like, Metallica did it.
Yeah. Well, of course, it would take all the fun out of it, you know?
Yeah.
You guys got to sort it out yourself, and you have to do it in front of the microphone. And it's, I can't believe, I don't know where you get that stuff. I mean, the last time I saw you, I saw your special, you know, the one, I don't know if you've had one since then, but, the one that... The
striped shirt or black shirt?
I don't remember.
I know you're a rock star. You don't have time to keep up with me.
It was funny as hell from beginning to end. And you know, then when I saw you and I saw you live, and you know, at that's a thing there over at
The Leary thing,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was, I don't know how you do it, man. It's like you're standing there in front of, like I said, that microphone, man, and you're making something out of nothing, and
you know what it is, Joe? I dropped the F-bomb. It's all the F-bomb and silly faces.
Yeah.
That's basically...
You know, it's funny, it's like...
level of my comedy.
I met William H. Macy once at a show, and he was like so wide-eyed, and he was like, Jesus Christ, you're fucking crazy. I would do that with a loaded gun to my head. He's like going off, and then finally I go, hey, you know, Bill, you've done some pretty cool stuff yourself. Yeah. Like, again, it's like we're talking to Joe Perry, and Joe's like, I don't know how you guys stand in front of that mic. It's like,
you know,
dude,
it's funny. You know what I love about stand-up comedy? It gets so much respect. But the gigs are so disrespectful. Like, yeah, we don't have a microphone. Can you go stand on a picnic table in the corner?
Yeah.
It's going to be broad daylight, too. Hey, good luck to you.
I was talking to Patrice about it once. People look at stand-up comedy the way you look at Evel Knievel, you know?
Yeah.
You're like, I can't believe that guy just jumped over 6 cars, but he still did it in a dirt fucking track, you know, behind some liquor store somewhere. You know what I mean? It's never an elegant gig or an affair. It's always
Yeah, you know what I wanted to ask you, Joe, just as far as like a geek question? What do you do like when you were in like you played like the Super Bowl or when you guys played like I've always seen the footage when you guys played like the Cotton Bowl at that big Texas Jam thing when there's like 80,000 people, how do you not feel like you're only like 2 inches tall when you go out there? Do you just like look down and not look at them, or are you just so cool that it doesn't bug you?
You just kind of like, you really can't see past the 10th row. I mean, that's the bottom line, is that all the lights that come, that hit you, like the, what you know, all the rock star lights, you know, and they reflect off the stage and they go out into the audience, but you can't really see much past that. So you just kind of, you know, and then there's this kind of dull roar, you know, from way
in the back.
You know that they're out there. It's kind of like standing on the beach at night. You know, you see the waves just down at your feet, but you know there's a lot more to it than that. You know
that's
what I
awesome
mean?
Analogy.
You know, I was going to say that, yeah. That's what it's like being. It's like you're playing in front of the ocean.
That's
and
awesome.
So, but you know they can't get. You know, you just kind of. You know they're out there, but you can't, you really can't think about it. But when it's televised and it's something like that, then you every once in a while, it's like when you're climbing up something high, you don't look down. You know, it's like don't think about that 40 million people are watching.
Right.
You know, because you just can't think that, because as soon as you
what's the most annoying thing that you find like as that fans can do. Like, I know fans, for the most part, cheer on it. What's the most, like, as a comedian, obviously we hate when people heckle us or they don't pay attention. As a rock star musician, what's the most annoying thing that you find that fans
in Europe,
do?
In Europe and in South America, they tend to deem it a sign of respect and I don't know, that they love you by spitting on you. And it's
what?
Like, you're trying to figure that one out.
But did somebody tell you that before you went down there?
They warned you. You know, the last band through warned you, and they go, oh, by the way, they like to spit. Carve out your area, like about 20 feet from the front of the stage.
Have you ever performed in a third world country and you get spit on? You're like, oh God!
All you're gonna do is get hit once, and you gotta work hard to keep the bile from spewing out of your nose.
I got Ebola. I got rock star Ebola.
It's horrible, and it's like I think they do it in I don't know, some gigs in England. You know what I mean? When you're playing in certain parts of the country where they really go for it, and also down in South America and a couple of places, you know, and you just...
So does that mean people in the front row are getting hit with people who don't quite spit to the stage?
Definitely. Oh, yeah, and then they're like hucking them up. I don't know where it comes from, man. It's like, I don't know if they're like...
It's that train spotting sort of mucus?
Mouthfuls of Coke or whatever they do, and they just slosh it around and they these big gobs of whatever. But so, like I said, you just kind of you know it's coming, so you kind of stand back away.
Do you have I'm gonna get spit on outfit that you wear on nights like that?
special
pair of leather pants.
Stand back. They clean the girls you get the stuff cleaned. You know what I mean? If you manage to get hit, Steven, who like nothing stops him. He'll still go out there and, you know, put on the show. Because, you know, people, you know, 100 feet, 200 feet away from the stage, they don't know what's going on. And, you know, if they see you, like, cowering behind the amps, it doesn't do the show any good. So, you know, he gets out there and still
bare-chested and just takes a...
And he's dripping. You know, but
yeah, I have a Faith No More bootleg from, like, I think they're in like Barcelona or something, and there's so much spit coming at the stage. I mean, the first time I saw it, I was like, "What the fuck is that? Confetti or some shit?"
Yeah.
And I realized it's spit. And then Mike Patton gets right down and he's letting the people spit into his mouth.
Ah, God.
It's foul.
Jesus,
it's
Christ.
Foul, man. It's nasty.
And it's slippery and it's like bad. Anyway, so that's I would have to say that's the worst. You know what I mean? We've had. You know, there's the odd, you know, rubber doll, this, you know, empty bottles. I mean, the odd things. But most people realize that you know, you throw something up there that can cause death or
just annoy the shit out of somebody
like that. That's like the show stops. So, you know, they don't want that.
You know, I saw a clip on YouTube of Angus Young, somebody dumping a beer on him. And, like, if I swear to God, if he could have twisted the guy's head off, he would have. But, you know, speaking at, like, AC/DC, I read a quote from you and Rolling Stone talking about how those guys opened for you when they first came around when they had, like, Bon Scott.
Right.
And me and Joe, we're huge AC/DC fans. Was that one of the bands the second you saw them, did you know that they were going to hit?
They were, you know, they were smoking. You know, back then they were, you know, there was a lot more. It was all about live. It was all about, you know, having great songs and right. having them go down live. And they were like, I couldn't believe it because every song was amazing. And they were just, you know, they had like simmered. It was like the difference between near beer and Jack Daniels. And they were Jack Daniels. You know, I mean, they were the real stuff.
So were you actually sitting there like, man, I got to bring my A game after that? You must have been.
Of course. Are you kidding? It was, you know, we got to follow that, you know.
What's the toughest band you had to follow when you were coming up? Once you guys became headliners in that, what's like, what are the bands that made you guys work the most?
Well, besides them, just strictly because they did it just because the music was great. Of course, they put on a great show. I mean, it was awesome. And, you know, all of them. And, geez, you look at Bon, and you knew that guy had put, you know, miles and miles and miles,
right.
You know, in a van, you know, dodging kangaroos, going from, yeah. you know, club to club, you know.
Did you have a party with Bon Scott?
Yeah. You know,
oh, my God. It's the coolest thing ever.
Really hard to understand. He, I think he was Scottish by way of, you know,
Australia.
And just his accent was so bizarre. And but, you know, the drunker we got, the easier it was to communicate. and he was just, you know, it was hard to understand them, all of them, because they were really quiet guys. I mean, they just kind of sat in the... Angus would sit in the corner with a cigarette and a guitar. He always had a guitar in his hand. And I can remember him having... They went over to Brad's house one night when they were in town. And you know, he had a party with him. And I said, how did it go? And he said, they drank everything in the house. And it was... you know, back then we used to have, you know, like we used to actually have, you know, cases of wine and... You know, cases of Jack, and you know, fairly substantial rooms full of booze.
Yeah, it was the '70s.
If he said that they drank everything in his, that was an amazing achievement. And you know, and they got up and walked. You know, when the party was over, they got up and walked. To their car, and that was it.
Well, that was the '70s when you didn't really have to worry about drinking and driving because your car was so big.
Right.
If you hit a tree, the tree was the thing that died.
Yeah, you had to get home, you know.
Joe, who was it? Speaking of Angus and these, Bill and I were talking about this last night at the bar, and you, of course, being one of the guitar gods, in our opinion, who are the guys you think look the coolest playing guitar? Because Angus is way up there. One of my votes was for Zappa, of course, with his, you know, almost seizure-like approach to playing the guitar. I always enjoyed watching that. Who's the guy that you're just like, you know, Christ, look at that dude. Like,
well, Jimmy Page, you know, the guitar strap got longer and longer as the band got bigger, and it was, he would be so into his playing that he couldn't keep a cigarette lit because the sweat would come off his face and put the cigarette out, and then he'd have to get it lit again, and then he'd, you know, a new one, then that would go out. And
how many times did you see Zeppelin?
Actually, I saw them once in Madison Square Garden, probably around 73 or 74.
Did you actually get to meet those guys?
Yeah.
No, he has this fan. Did you get to drink with John Bonham?
No, I didn't see him. They didn't really hang out at the gigs. They would get there like 5 minutes before they were going to go on, and none of this, you know, backstage shit. Oh. I mean, it was just
did Peter Grant rough you up at all? Is he trying to get backstage?
No, we all kind of got along. He was okay. And, you know, I after that, I got to know Jimmy pretty well. And then And in the 80s, and actually he met his last wife in Argentina at one of our gigs in Argentina. He was there. I think they were doing some promotion, and he came back to see us, and she was back there, and he met her, so anyway, we've gotten to be friends since then.
Well, what do you got, so we can hype your stuff? What do you got coming up here? I know you said you guys are working on an album. I was reading on your website. You guys possibly have an upcoming tour starting in March. Is that true?
Probably March or April. It's going to be. We're just setting the dates now, and that's kind of the plan. You know, we're really going to pull out all the stops and try and get this record done. You know,
awesome. Joe, you can do it, man.
Yeah.
You can do it. You really got, like, you sound like you got the weight of the world on you right now. You're just like, yeah, we got to do this album, and I got this tour.
Hey,
come
by
on,
the
man.
Way.
There's no way that you can do this for 35, 40 years having killer albums. There's no way.
Joe.
You know, if you were going to dry up, that would have happened 30 years ago.
Joe, by the way, this should pep you up a little bit. I'm a big Guitar Hero fan, and I got Guitar Hero Aerosmith for my birthday. My buddy gave it to me.
Oh, yeah?
And Train Kept a Rolling. I really, you made me curse words that I didn't even know existed. It was so fucking hard. I was screaming. And you know what was really hard was Pink. Pink's one of the bonus tracks. Pink was the hardest song in the game. And I thought, you know, that's one of the poppier, slower tunes. I was like, Pink will probably kind of easy.
I just love how you're talking to a guitar hero about playing Guitar Hero. A guy who can actually... You know, Beethoven, I was on this Fisher-Price piano the other day.
But Joe, Pink is the hardest song in the fucking game. I couldn't, like, I thought it would be, you know, let's put it this way. I would think Train Kept Rolling or Walk This Way would have been harder to play than Pink or Sweet Emotion. I couldn't beat Pink. I was screaming at the goddamn TV. I couldn't beat the song.
I got to pick that up though. But I also know, Joe, you got that the line of food that you've been putting out too?
Yeah, we're doing, we've got the hot sauce out there, but we're going to be doing we call it rock and roni, macaroni and cheese kind of thing. And
hey, can I apologize?
I don't know how we ever got this deep into it, but it just was, we were having so much fun with it we're going to do it and see what happens, you know?
All right. Well, I got to apologize for the bad copy. Like a year ago, Aaron, your son, came to me like they were saying, hey, maybe we could have a comedian. I don't know if he ever told you about this, Joe, to write on the back of their stuff. That was the hardest thing I ever had to do. And I finally, like, I think the stuff I turned in had, like, curses in it. And, like...
All right. That was great. That was
oh, you did
so
like
good.
It? I was just picturing Joe Perry looking at it going, who is this fucking idiot? I'm trying to make money and just throwing the container across. Well,
I just like that. Out of all the fantasies that I've had about, like, what would it be like to be in, like, a super legendary rock band, you just hit me with one that I never would think of, Joe. Like, you're like, yeah, we're going to put out some mac and cheese. Fuck it. We'll see what happens.
Yeah.
You know, like, just, that's what I'm going to do this month. I'm just, I'm sitting in my apartment every month, like, it's I got to like, pay the rent.
You sit around and you kind of, well, you know, we can't make money from selling records anymore.
Right.
You know, got to do something. So,
yeah, how do you feel about that? I know, what do you think about it, the way AC/DC went about it? Because personally, I actually went to their website and I ordered the album. And, I mean, I'm not going to lie to you, man. I've definitely downloaded. I did the what the hell was that? The one over there.
iTunes?
Not iTunes. The one where you basically stole it. And I used to get all
like
viruses.
Napster
so I finally stopped because, you know, I was never one of those guys who just said, you know, I'm not stealing, it's sharing. I knew I was stealing. So how do you feel about all that type of stuff? Like, have you guys, like, thought about maybe just doing what AC/DC did on your next album, trying something
probably,
like that?
We probably will, because it seems to work to at least sell the plastic, whether it's a CD. And, you know, it'd be nice to do some kind of a packaging thing. I really, you know, I have a turntable and some speakers and actually listen to vinyl. And one of the things I miss about that is the size of the package.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You get all these great pictures, and you know, you get to read some liner notes. You don't have to use a magnifying glass. It's like it's really cool, you know, and maybe we can do something like that and do some special releases where you got, you know, you can still put the CD in there, but maybe make the packaging bigger. I don't know.
You know what's funny about that? My I can't say the first album I ever got, the second album I got, because the first album my mother bought me was Sing Along with Mitch Miller and the Gang.
Right.
Had like Roll Out the Barrel. But the second one I got was Aerosmith's Greatest Hit. I remember it was that big red album.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, I can't remember if they had pictures on the inside sleeve, but this was before MTV, so back then, because Joe's like 10 years younger than me, DeRosa, I had no idea what they looked like at that point, you know
right.
what I mean? So you literally, I don't know, you had to somehow, like, I remember looking on the back of a lot of albums back then, if they didn't have the names of the guys, like, I remember when I first saw the Highway to Hell album, I was trying to figure out which one was Bond.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Well,
no,
that's
no.
the thing, I mean, it was like, back then, before you had MTV and all this stuff on video, it's like, you had to see them live if you wanted to actually see them moving. Otherwise, it was a still picture, you know. And it's like there was a lot of magic to that, you know. I missed that part of it, you know. But you gotta you gotta either embrace it, and move ahead, or you kind of get stuck behind. So
you know what I wanted to ask you about is how come all these older guitars? This might be too nerdy a question for our listeners. How come like? You look at these older Les Pauls and Strats, and they're all beat up and stuff, and for some reason they're like $100,000, $30,000, and when the new ones are only a couple of grand. How come those old ones are worth so much money?
Well, because they're the guitars that are actually were used back in the heyday of the, you know, when Clapton first, you know, played the lick that you know, turned around and, you know, Clapton is God written on the side of a railway trestle, you know. So those were the guitars that they used, and to actually get one that's from that era.
I mean, do they sound differently?
They actually do sound. Some of them actually do sound better than the new ones, but it's also because they're rare. You know, they didn't make that many of them when you consider, like, maybe they made, I don't know, 7,000 all told, you know, for like those Les Pauls. You know, that's not many to go around, you know. And so they end up, it ends up being like art, you know. People, you know, it's just, they're not making it anymore, and there's nothing you can do about it. You know, the stuff just gets, and it also seasons, you know, wood dries out. There's all this other, folklore, and
right.
Some of it's real, some of it's just old wives' tales and that kind of stuff. But
right.
But for me, I can definitely say that I've played some of the older ones, and they do sound better. You know, like you get an old acoustic guitar from the 30s. There's nothing you can do to make a new guitar sound like that. You know,
so it's like wine or something like that.
Exactly. It,
you know what? I wish I had that gift where I could tell the difference, because I got to be honest with you, Joe. You could literally play something on a 1930s guitar or a brand new ukulele, and I'm so tone deaf. I'd be like, yeah, sounds the exact same.
That's the other thing. It's like, you know, do you really need to play? I mean, if you have to listen that hard to notice the difference, I mean, if you blindfolded me and you know, somebody played a new Les Paul through a Marshall, and then you play that an old one. You know, you may or may not notice the difference. You know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, there's very often I'll be in the studio and I will actually pick up a new one because it's for that song, it works better. You know, it's a matter of taste.
So what are you going to grab today after this? Now that you're inspired to go downstairs,
probably go down and get clear guitar that's on.
Done with mirrors.
Yeah, I mean it's a clear guitar, and it's a Dan Armstrong. That's what I'm gonna play.
Right. There you go.
Sweet.
And
Joe, you can do it, man.
Has your mood been lifted?
He's just
Joe. Has your mood been lifted at all? Has this
my what?
Has your mood been lifted at all? Has
this
pepped you up a little bit?
It's great.
Yeah, we were a little timid, man. This is like the biggest. You're the biggest guest we've had, so I didn't want to interrupt or anything like that.
We'll do this again tomorrow, right?
Well, yeah, well, you know, we'll talk you right through it.
Right, that'll be great.
We'll talk you right through the album. So what do you drink now? You drink like a keg of coffee, and you stay up till like 4 in the morning?
Yeah.
Well,
lately I've been, you know, been watching the all the politics, you know, kind of really, you know, once they start repeating themselves on TV, then I go to the internet. Billy and I go on the internet and start, you know, digging in there. And
Oh my God, are you into conspiracy theory? Please tell me you are.
Of course,
you are. Have you watched all those Zeitgeist and all that type of thing?
Forget it. It's unbelievable.
Now let me ask you this. Oh, this is the best. Do you believe in that stuff? Because I'm all over it.
I am definitely. I mean, we just. I don't know.
Who have you tracked it down to? Who do you think runs the world?
Oh, God, there's a couple of different levels, I think, of the guys in the dark room. You know, like in the X-Files, where they have the guys that made the deal with the aliens.
Yeah.
Kind of that thing. And,
the shapeshifters.
So there are different. I think there are different groups of them around the world, and that have different. You know, basically, I mean, they have different interests, but it's basically the same. It's, you know,
you know what I think it is?
Keeping themselves rich and keeping themselves powerful.
I think It goes down to the Rothschilds. That's where I traced it back to.
Yeah?
At first I thought it was J.P. Morgan, but then I realized he was just an agent for them.
Yeah, well, there's another layer. It's there's one that goes back, I don't know if it's Rothschild or I think it might be, actually, that goes back, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years, you know, way back. They can trace it back to the Templars and all that. It's
love about this is you're totally valid. Everybody says that I'm out of my mind, and I can now say, well, you know what? I had a conversation with Joe Perry.
Joe Perry thinks it too.
He thinks it too.
my wife and I, Billy and I, we buy all those. 20 years ago, we went through all those UFO tapes you could buy. You know, over in Cambridge, there was a shop like right around the corner from the.
So this is like pre-YouTube. You had to actually go down and get the VHS tapes.
Yeah, it was right around the corner from House of Blues. There was a little kind of new agey kind of place.
Right.
They had a shelf full of these like homemade. UFO tapes, you know, the Brazil ones, and ones from Mexico.
Oh, so you're into aliens? You believe in aliens?
Well, all of it, you know, everything. I mean, I'll tell you, we're still waiting to see one, but you know, I've talked to people that swear that they've seen them, and you know, I believe. You
I
know,
love it.
I'm still waiting to see something come crawling out of the woods, you know.
He's into it deeper than I am because I draw the line at aliens. Like, I don't know if there's some out there, but like, you know, I don't get into the flying saucers. I'm just more into evil bankers.
Well, we have three levels here because I'm way more conservative about this stuff than you are, and you're a little more conservative than Joe Perry is.
Joe takes it all the way to the guy in the
moon.
I
like that. Joe, if you're going to go all the fucking way with it, man.
Yeah, you know? Why don't you write a song about that? Write a song about the Illuminati. There's gotta be, has anybody ever done that? There's a concept album.
Yeah.
You know what? That's great, Joe. You've been successful for 40 years. Why don't you take advice from me? how to run your career right off the rails. Yeah, that's a great idea. Do a rock opera.
Illuminati. Now you're talking.
Yeah. I'd like to hear that. I'd like to hear Steven do a couple of, you know, an Illuminati song.
No, I'm reading a book right now about this, just what we're talking about the economic.
Oh, Confessions of an Economic Hitman.
Yeah.
John Perkins.
Yeah.
Yeah, I read that.
And that's amazing. You know, it's there. They're out there, you know. So.
You know what? It contributes to your mood, though, Joe. I'm telling you, if you read too much of it, you're going to get depressed. And it gets too overwhelming. So we got to leave you on a high note. Why would I end on conspiracy theory?
I don't think it affects your mood because I don't really buy into any of it, and I'm still a depressed, miserable. It's something's going to get to you. You know what I mean?
You know what it is? It's like, you know, you got to make the best of what you can, you know, of what you can, you know, really touch, see, shout at, you know what I mean? Whatever is in your range of your world, and you kind of make the best of it.
You know what you got to do?
You got to get a puppy.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And real quick, too, before he go, let's plug your the kids' band, man. How's the, how are you?
Tab,
how are your kids doing with their band?
They're doing good. They're keeping their day jobs, which is really important.
Right.
But, you know, I told them basically if they, you know, as long as they did that, I'd help them out as much as I could. And, you know, they get to use this amp or that amp, or and they're working hard. You know, they work during the week and go. You know, Tony's going to school and Adrian's working in New York, and then they get together and they gig. I guess they get a short gig with Weiland.
We saw them live in New York. They were great. So anybody listening, definitely go out and check out Tab.
Playing with Weiland, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah,
Jesus.
Yeah. They're moving up. Well,
they hooked up when they played with STP a while ago. And,
wow.
And the guys in STP are old friends of ours, so I guess Weiland wanted to give him a helping hand, and it's going to be good.
That's awesome, man. All right. We'll send those kids our best. They're good dudes. I hang with them whenever they're in New York playing. And of course, Aaron is a great kid.
Joe, you sound like an old man. Well, yeah, say hello to the kids. You're their age.
It's so funny. As we're talking to them, I'm sitting here like, this is pretty cool. We're talking to Joe Perry. And then I forget, like, I'm friends with his kids. Like, yeah, it's like two different things. So it's thank you for calling in, man.
Well, sure. It was a lot of fun. I was actually looking forward to this one.
Well, listen, you guys.
Sweet,
keep...
man. Thank you for that. We appreciate that.
Yeah. And like I said, I saw you, man. It's been 20 years since I've seen you guys. Keep getting better. So, you know, just stop reading about the conspiracy theory, you know. Like I said, have the cup of coffee.
I'll let you know if I see anything, okay?
Okay, absolutely. All right, Joe. Thanks a lot, man.
All right, guys. We'll see you.
All right,
see
take
you,
it easy.
Bye.
Bye.
All right, obviously now we got to take a break here. That was Joe Perry from Aerosmith. I probably should have said that at some point during the... why didn't I think to say that during the radio thing? You were talking about Joe Perry from Aerosmith. Be like the...
Because we're
idiots, yeah, right? All right, well, you're listening to Uninformed. Keep it here for the final hour.
Uninformed with Bill Burr and Joe DeRosa.
AC/DC Radio.
The only channel playing non-stop AC/DC music.
Wow!
AC/DC Radio.
Hear songs from their new CD, Black Ice. Their first in 8 years. Out now.
Welcome to the sounds of thunder.
I'm Angus Young from AC/DC.
From down under.
This is Brian Johnson, and let's keep it rocking on AC/DC Radio.
XM Channel 53.
Hi, this is Kristen,
Kelsey,
and Cassidy.
And we're Shadaisy.
Being on tour is great, but after 23 days on the road, we cannot wait to get home to family and friends.
And to our own sleep number beds. My sleep number is 50.
I'm a 40. And I'm a 25.
The tougher your days, the more you deserve a sleep number night. A sleep number bed lets you personalize your comfort at the touch of a button. Inner spring and foam beds don't. A higher sleep number setting for more firmness, a lower number for softer support. And since every day is different, you'll always find your perfect sleep number setting anytime. Because the most comfortable sleep is the one you control yourself.
23 days of Tennessee time and I'm back to you.
Experience the difference a sleep number bed makes every night. Call 1-800-372-6100 for your free information kit with brochure, DVD, and price list. That's 1-800-372-6100. Sleep number by Select Comfort. It's the bed that counts.
How are you protecting yourself financially from the subprime crisis or from record oil prices? What are you doing about falling home values or a plummeting dollar? Now more than ever, this is the time to diversify your assets by investing in gold. Just call Goldline for a free information packet at 800-711-9083. Since 2001, gold prices have tripled, and many experts still predict record highs. With as little as $1,000, you can acquire physical gold shipped right to you. Call Goldline now, and they'll send you a free information packet and CD that shows you step-by-step how you can acquire gold. Call 800-711-9083. The call and the information are free, and there's no obligation. In today's economy, diversify your investments with the power of gold. Call Goldline right now for your free information. Call 800-711-9083. That's 800-711-9083.
Business owners, Amerimerchant can provide your business up to $200,000 in working capital in 7 days or less without the hassle of a bank. And unlike a bank, we have a 90% approval rate. Turn your future credit sales from your customers into fast cash. You can use the money for anything you choose, such as expansion, marketing, purchasing inventory, paying off debt, buying out investors or partners, acquiring other business. Call 877-469-6520. Amerimerchant offers you a no-hassle application with simple, easy steps. We offer multiple cash advance programs that can get your business up to $200,000 right away. With approvals as fast as 24 hours, pay back with your future credit card transactions from your customers. If you have $5,000 per month in credit card sales from your customers, you may qualify. Call Amerimerchant now to find out how much you may qualify for today. Call 877-469-6520. That's 877-469-6520. That's 1-877-469-6520.
The best action, players, coaches, and fans that sports has to offer.
He fumbled the football.
XM's lineup delivers the most sports and play-by-play coverage to listeners and fans across the country.
The rebound, open net, Nolan scores.
Tune in to XM Sports Nation, channel 144, or log on to XMRadio.com for game times and listening.
He's got the two-hand cam.
XM Sports, brought to you by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you've got to get DirecTV.
Replace your regularly scheduled program to bring you this goddamn special-ass episode of Uninformed.
Uninformed.
Welcome to the Uninformed Mixtape, sluts. I'm your host, Bernard Valentine, from the world's nastiest sex rap group, Deep, the Uninformed Mixtape.
Uninformed.
Tonight we're gonna bless that ass with some of Bill and Joe's greatest goddamn hits. And in addition to that bullshit, we're going to shove some brand new exclusive cuts right up your pee hole. Also tonight, a brand new discussion with a real live 5-0. That's right, we're going to pick the motherfucking brain of a motherfucking ex-cop. Fuck you!
Uninformed.
The Uninformed Mixtape, tonight, right now. This episode has been pre-recorded, so that means don't try calling in, you stupid asshole. If you got some shit to say, email it to uninformedradio@gmail.com. Otherwise, shut the fuck up! Hey yo, enough fucking around. Let's start this shit. Here's a brand new, hot off the press discussion between Bill and Joe.
Uninformed.
I could not sleep last night, man. I knew we had to get up today.
I know, dude. You look like shit
to do this because you know, we're out every night doing shows. Till late, so to get up at 10 a.m.
We're out there on the circuit.
To get up at 10 a.m. to be in here by 12 to do like this pre-recorded episode, I was like, all right, I'm going to go right home after my spots and, you know, and go right to bed at like 3 a.m. and try to get 6 or 7 hours of sleep.
I'm trying to be responsible.
Yeah, and I didn't drink. I just went right home. And, dude, I was just laying in my bed till 7 a.m. I could not sleep. I tried reading for a while. I didn't fall asleep. I'm reading.
That's the worst.
And I'm reading Wicked, which.
What is that? That like, sounds that, like something a divorced woman would read on a
I
beach.
I know, that's exactly.
In the middle of summer.
It's that book they based that musical on, about the Witches of Oz, where, you know, the posters, it's like Wicked, a new musical about the Witches of Oz.
Can I tell you something? I don't know what one of those fucking musicals about Chicago. Oklahoma, any of them. It's just a bunch of people in people in frilly dresses over there.
Yeah,
just singing songs.
Fruits over there. Yeah. And the slogan on the poster, it shows the two witches from the Wizard of Oz, and then the slogan is, "A whole lot happened before Dorothy dropped in." You know, it's real sassy.
Oh, my
God. So I'm reading that book right now. So
why
I just,
do you have that book, first of all?
My roommate had it. She had it, and I was like, I'm going to read
she
this.
She had it? Or
yeah,
he had
she,
it?
She. So I wanted to read it. So I was laying there reading that, sober, and just feeling like such a fucking like fruity douche. Just curled up in my bed, trying to fall asleep. So then
are you wearing pajamas?
Yeah.
In a sports bra?
Yeah, I was wearing sweats rolled up at the waist.
those stupid slippers with like an animal. I tell you, when you hook up with a girl and she has like that still like stuffed animals and crap on her bed, I've always found that just it's
weird.
Pedophile is in the air when that shit happens.
It's weird. Like, I kind of hate it, but I kind of think it's cute and like comforting a little bit. Like, I feel good. Like, I'm like, all right, this chick's at least not a skank. You know, she's not like the chick.
That's all a girl needs.
Yeah, that's it.
To convince you that she never let anybody go raw in her as a little stuffed bunny.
That's it. I
usually look at the bookshelf. I look at some of the books that they had.
Sometimes I get creeped out, though, if the books are too, like, sort of intellectual or whatever. You know what I mean? It freaks me out a little bit.
No, Joe, that means she wants it in the ass.
That's what I mean. I feel
she's
like that's
too
somebody
much power at work. Just push her face right near the pillow.
So,
I hooked up with a girl one time and I was looking up and she had one book up there. I swear to God, the name of the book was They Said It Wasn't Rape. And I was literally waiting for the first time I touched this girl for her to just be curled up in a ball like with a purple crayon just drawing on the sheet or something, you know? I was just like, no, it made me like nervous, like thinking like, what happened to this girl? And I don't want to have some sort of rape Vietnam flashback.
Jesus Christ.
And I go to put my hand up her shirt there.
Did you ask her what the book was about?
No, you know what? I waited to the second or third time, and she was just more like into like, she went through a woman's movement kind of phase. So then, of course, I trashed her.
Dude, I hooked up with this girl the other night, and
was she hot?
She was pretty hot, but she had like a, I was taking her shirt up, and she had like a stretch mark on her stomach, and she was like, I'm kind of embarrassed. She was in her 30s, and she goes, I had a baby when I was 17, so I have some stretch marks. And I just let it go. I didn't ask any questions. I was so afraid to ask, well, what happened? Like, did you get it?
Yeah, what do you not get stretch marks when you're in your 30s and you have a baby?
Well, no, I'm saying, she was just like, I had a baby when I was 17, and that was all she said. And I was so afraid to ask her, well, do you still have it? Or like, I was afraid she was going to be like, I gave him up for adoption. Not a day goes by.
Oh. You know, I tried to hide the pregnancy. I had the baby in the toilet. Do you remember that story in the Post? That was me.
Yeah, dude.
It was me.
I was so fucking scared, dude. That's what it's all about for me anymore, though, is bringing out the depression in a woman when I try to fuck her.
When you try to take him down.
I have a new joke in my act where I say, after I fuck a girl, I want her to get up from my bed and walk directly to the window and jump out of it.
Jesus Christ, Joe.
I want to just bring out all the pain. I want it to be very therapeutic.
I try to get them to talk about sex. I got really hacky. I try to draw out the whore within, like their inner whore. You know what I mean? You ever try that? You basically, it's the old thing. You kind of admit, you know, when you start talking about sexual fantasies, you just admit to something that you want to do that is just so far down the road that anything that she was actually thinking of admitting will pale in comparison.
And then she'll admit, like, her hoary shit.
Yeah, this is all in theory. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It's kind of like shooting a pilot, Joe, you know? You don't know if it's going to get picked up or not, but, you know, everybody's got a good feeling about the script.
It's hard to get into the sexual discussion sometimes. You know, sometimes the jump is too drastic from what you're actually talking about. You're trying to work it in, and she keeps talking about recipes and shit.
That's bad.
Yeah, you're trying to ease your way into some kind of ass sex discussion, and it's fucking impossible half the time.
You know what's funny is I have no idea how I do it. I was just trying to think. Maybe because I've been in a fucking relationship too long.
Sometimes you pull it off and the transition is seamless. And all of a sudden she's sitting there being like, yeah, you know, one time I let a guy come up my ass and then I shit it out into his mouth. And you're like, how the fuck did I get her to pull this out?
I know. And you were just talking about politics like a sec. I remember I hooked up with this girl one time and she'd come to my show or whatever. And for some stupid reason, I was so horny or whatever, I literally tried to make my move between the first and second show. Like, we're at the club. And I, like, grabbed her ass or something in the green room. Yeah, and she just looked at me like, what is wrong with you? And then my whole second set, I was just thinking, ah, man, I blew it or whatever. But for some reason, she still wanted to go out and have a drink with me. So we ended up going out to this bar, and we're having a drink. And this girl is, like, giving me the not until I see a ring vibe, you know? She coats on and all. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Well, I think this is our guest here. Lewis. All right. Yeah. Hey, Danny's going to let you in, okay? All right. All right. Bye. All right. So that was sort of unprofessional.
So we could just... Yeah.
No, we're not editing that out. We're going to show this. This is how it fucking works around here.
This is a pre-recorded show. If you
considering
if you
fucking
it in
the Danny
intro.
Didn't show up until 2 minutes before, there was no sense of urgency. But let's get back to the prude though.
That's but just to make the point. That's how much respect we have for the audience. That even in the pre-recorded state, go fuck yourself. We're not cutting out answering the phone.
What are we gonna do? Piss off 3 listeners? I mean, honestly, Jeff. Look, I'm shutting off my cell phone here.
So she's
giving me the whole Little House on the Prairie vibe, right? And, you know, coats on and that kind of thing. And, dude, I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened. All of a sudden, we're just talking, and, you know, it was really loud. We're kind of like this dance club or whatever. We're up at the bar. And all of a sudden, she sort of like talking, like, blah, 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 blah. Hosted a sex party, blah, 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 blah. And I just went, like, what? And all of a sudden, she just starts fucking talking about sex. Cause I wouldn't even bring it up at that point because I fucked up so bad at the club. And she starts telling me how she used to host sex parties. I'm like, what are you talking, like an orgy? She's like, yeah.
Jesus Christ.
And I was like, but where did you have? She was part of like a group. She goes, sometimes I would have them at my house, and then other times we would just rent a whole floor at a hotel, and people would just go from room to room to room. And I'm like, and you hosted this? And she's like, yeah. And I go, did you participate? She goes, yeah, you know, kind of. And it was the most fucked up thing. I literally went from thinking like, there's no way I'm getting laid to I'm definitely getting laid to I don't want to touch this girl because I'm going to get fucking AIDS or something. And somehow she still ended up coming back to my hotel room. And
did you bang her?
No, we messed around a little bit, and I didn't have a condom or anything, and there was no way I was going near it. And then she said, "Say, have you ever heard of mutual masturbation?" And I was like, yeah, I can do that.
That's a great feeling sometimes.
Just sort of rubbed one out.
When you get the nut, when it's the chick where you're like, if I fuck this girl, I'm immediately...
Oh, yeah, I'm at a clinic.
Yeah, and I'm going to regret it.
Oh, who's kidding? No, the reality is I'll be thinking I need to go to a clinic for the next 8 years until I finally meet a woman responsible enough to tell me that I need to go.
Oh, that's brutal, dude.
That's the girl I'm going to be thinking of.
Oh, that's brutal. I just did the clinic run.
I know. You just went down there.
Yeah.
How does it feel, Joe?
Feels great. I keep saying it's like the feeling you have after you go to confession. You're just like, well, that skanky shit is gone.
Yeah.
You know, like,
who was the one you were worried about with your, your
Jesus,
HIV test?
Dude. I had a couple doozies on the... Now, I always wear a condom. Always.
Yeah, for those people listening... Joe DeRosa is like, you're like the kid from the high school film strip.
Yeah.
As far as, Danny, do you realize Joe DeRosa, you told me you've never gone
ever.
Raw.
Never.
Ever.
Ever. Never ever in my life have I ever raw dogged a girl, ever.
And how old are you?
29.
Why?
But.
Why not?
Because I'm terrified to catch something. I'm horrified. Danny, I have meltdowns. I fuck girls with like hefty bag condoms on. You know,
this
and I'm
thing,
like
and
in
then,
a plutonium and suit, and I'm still worried that I caught something. You know, I'm just like, it scares the shit out of me.
And
I'm
he
terrified.
Was sweating. He was actually sweating, like going down there, getting like, he's like, oh man, whoo.
In my defense,
thank God. In your defense, what?
In my defense, I have fucked some brutal skanks on the road. I'm not afraid to
girls. Girls with those vaginas that have the ability to eat through the hefty bag.
I told you, man. I fucked
hefty bag
like,
condom,
like alien blood.
Yeah, yeah. Danny, I fucked a girl in.
He fucks Sigourney Weaver.
I fucked a girl in Florida, which right there, the word Florida and I fucked a girl. That they should never go together. Florida and Jersey are the two states we should never sleep with anybody.
Oh, dude, you got to get some stats up, Danny. I want to see like a high risk state.
Dude, Danny, I fucked a girl in Florida. She was smoking hot. She looked like Brandy, the singer, right?
Uh-huh.
And we're in my hotel room, and I'm naked on the bed. And she takes my pants off, and she's looking at my dick, and she's giving me a hand job. And her phone rings, her cell phone rings. She literally answers the phone. She goes, yeah, girl, uh-huh. You know what I'm doing right now? I'm staring at a dick. And she goes... And she goes, that's right, girl. I got to go because I'm a suck it. And she, and she got on the phone and blew me. And then I fucked her. And I was like, oh, I'm finished. Whatever she's got, it burns through latex.
Dude, you know what? That sounds like dialogue for one of those bad blaxploitation movies that end up getting protested. That was actually...
I was waiting for her to somersault. You know, and then jump up with a handgun, you know, like Foxy Brown. It was fucking, dude, it was terrifying. Not terrifying enough for me to not fuck her.
I fucked this girl one time who was, she was such a skank and so came across like she wasn't even like an honest person. I forget what she said, but she had some sort of criminal past. So I'm always really bad about getting them out of my hotel room. So I was literally sleeping next to her, right? And my wallet and my watch were on the little fucking nightstand on her side of the bed. And literally the whole night I was sleeping in like 7-minute intervals. And I'd be sleeping and then like the paranoia while I'm in my sleep that she's going to steal my shit. Yeah. I would literally pop up and then look at her and make sure my wallet and my watch, that's right, was across on the dresser. That was brutal.
That sucks, dude. That sucks. Oh, my God. Well, that was another girl. I had one in Florida that used to be a stripper, and she was just skinny, which freaked me out. She was skinny.
Too old to be that skinny.
Yeah.
She didn't have a movie premiere coming out. There was no reason.
She was doing blow the entire time. Like, she just kept stopping whatever we're doing to do lines, and then she'd be like, and she literally goes, I'm sorry my vagina's so dry. I've just done so much blow tonight.
Oh, my God, Joe. I got to tell you something, man. My dick would have tapped out, just like in the UFC right there. It just would have been like, all right, I'm out.
Dude, a hard dick has no conscience, dude. It was ready, ready to go.
Dry vagina and coke boogers? That's enough for me, man. In Florida?
She was hot, though. She was a stripper. I was on, you know, I mean.
Oh, that was, you needed the stripper story?
That was, yeah, exactly.
I got
the test. I was in the clear. Everything was negative. And I also, it had been like, I had survived like the window. I hadn't fucked any girls in the, you know, when they're like, well, if it's been 3 months, conceivably. Like, I had gone celibate for 3 months. And then I got the test, and I was
celibate
clean.
From what, Joe? Not banging girls with condoms every single time?
No, dude. No, no. I'm saying I didn't fuck any girls in 3 months. And then I got the test, and it was all negative, and I was like, that's it. No,
Joe,
more
if
fucking.
If they took an X-ray
story
of your internal organs, I bet there's a rainbow. Just right over with, like, butterflies, like a Mariah Carey video.
Yeah, I guess so, man. I don't know. Sure.
You know what you like, Joe? You're like one of those guys in the army, like acting like you saw some action and you were actually in the back, like peeling potatoes. You're like, yeah. Just like that guy who called that one time. I saw a lot of crazy shit out there, man.
Well, that's my problem. Is like, I'm a real like pervert. Like, I love like filthy sex, but I'm also too careful. So I would be, you know, I'd be like the Marine with the knife in his teeth, like,
you'd be the guy who wore the helmet and they actually has the chin strap on.
Yeah, I'd be on the battlefield like, let's go kick some enemy ass. But hold on. Let's make sure everything's in order for, you know, let's do this. Let's think before we move here, people. But let's really, you know, like, it's a contradiction, dude. It sucks.
No, good. No, but you have to more worry about, because obviously you still go down on girls, oral sex and all that type of thing.
I won't go down on a lot of girls. I got to kind of know a girl a little before I go down on her. And
which
pretty
is what,
safe.
Joe? She has a stuffed animal, and you're like, okay,
yeah.
I'm
if
going
she's
in.
Got, if she's got a, you know, a Bert and Ernie on her bed, then that means she's clean to me. Literally go by the gauge of, well, she looks clean, like it, which is the worst.
Oh, absolutely.
But I totally go by that. You know, I totally go by that.
And as you can see, it works, Joe.
Mm-hmm.
You're clean.
Yeah, well, you know, what are you going to do?
You go, ladies. Joe DeRosa.
That was one of the things I did last
clean
night.
Clean as a whistle.
Was when I was trying to get to sleep. I was saying I couldn't get to sleep last night, and I watched this porno.
Do you blow more money on cabs or on condoms over the course of a year? You live all the way
condoms,
uptown.
You can get them for free at the clinic. They're free. I mean, do you spend money on
at the clinic? I don't even know where the clinic is.
Well, I do, Bill. And
is it like a little mobile home with the improvised wooden steps that you walk
into?
It's
like the bookmobile. they just come through town and make sure everybody's clean. I
don't even know.
I don't know.
Condoms to me, you go
you
to,
get them
you
in
go,
the street. I live in Harlem.
Reed.
I live in Harlem, so they give out. There's always like one of those tables in the street where they give you a bag of like a dozen condoms for free.
And a little pamphlet on sickle cell.
Yeah. The yeah, they'll give you like a bag of condoms for free and lube.
Oh my God, you're getting the fucking CIA condoms.
The conspiracy condoms.
Conspiracy condoms that they give to minorities to that don't work. That's why they keep having all those kids.
There's a government official down in the sewer grate next to the table poking holes through the
exactly.
through the condoms before he hands.
Did you see that white guy in the raincoat with like the sunglasses?
Dude, I watched this. I got to tell you this, dude. I watched this movie last night. I could not sleep, and I watched this movie called Seduced. These were the three movies I watched last night. One was
You stayed up until 7 in the morning.
Yeah, I couldn't sleep. So the first movie I was watching was called Seduced by Evil, and it was a Suzanne Summers movie. Suzanne Summers from
Chrissy
from Three's Company. Well, you hear the title, and you think, oh, this is going to be softcore porn. She's going to show her tits. This is going to be awesome.
Yeah, she uses the Thighmaster.
Yeah, and it's not. It was a fucking Lifetime movie that they were rerunning on HBO.
And what was it called?
Seduced by Evil.
Oh, God. What did the guy do?
She goes to, like, a shaman who puts a spell on her. And I don't know, dude. I couldn't follow it. It was, you know, it was 4 o'clock in the morning. I was seeing, you know, double.
And you're just sitting
delirium.
There with your dick in your hand waiting for something to jerk off to.
No, I'd already masturbated twice before I turned the movie on. But I just wanted to see if
see. Wicked?
Suzanne. No, actually, I ran into that guy, Yoshi, that works for Evil Angel, and he gave me a copy of Butthole Whores, it was called, which I wasn't able to put together what the movie was about specifically. It was
Our
a little highbrow.
Guest is here. Serpico just showed up. Yeah. We were talking to a retired police officer.
In a little bit. But, dude, here's the thing. I was watching this movie, and all I could think about the whole time, this movie was made in 1994. It was the worst fucking thing. It was like they made a... You know, it was like a Danielle Steele novel turned into a movie gone wrong. It was horrible. And I'm watching it. And I remember watching the E! True Hollywood Story about Three's Company and how
Joe, do you watch anything of quality?
She left the show. Three's Company was
watching the
REO
Speedwagon behind the music.
Three's
and
Company,
I just noticed
Bite your tongue. Three's Company was a great fucking... Ugh. Come on, man. Well, you're a little older than I. You know, I was 5 when I watched Three's Company. How old were you? How old were you when you watched Three's Company?
I'm only 10 years
old. You're probably a solid 26, 27.
No, Three's Company, I was like 12.
No. Well, you didn't like Three's Company?
I mean, then.
Well, either way, it doesn't matter.
I liked the Sweat Hogs and that shit back then, but now when I watch Horseshack, he doesn't make me laugh anymore.
Mr. Cartier.
Oh. Yeah, somehow it just doesn't have the same effect.
That's not Horseshack. Anyway, who cares? The point is, I remember watching the E! True Hollywood Story about Suzanne Summer, and she left that show because she was immensely popular on the show, and she was like, her people, her agents, whatever, they felt that she was the reason that that show was so successful, and she demanded, like, you know, she pulled the Brad Garrett thing when she was like, I want this much per episode or I'm fucking leaving. And they were like, hey, fucking leave then. We'll replace you with another hot blonde. We don't give a shit. And that's when Terry came in. And I'm like,
and the
Jesus
show sucked
Christ.
After that.
Yeah, and I was like, this chick was... I mean, she was there. She was like at that, you know, position where it was like, I'm here, I'm in, I made it, I that's it, a car blind. And then that was it, dude. What did she do after that?
Like that chick, Rhoda. Didn't she do the same shit?
Valerie Harper? Yeah, she left the Hogan family.
Yeah.
It was called the Valerie Harper Show, whatever. And she left and they went, hey, go fuck yourself. We'll change you to the Hogan family.
Yeah, and I just wrote it in that she
and
died.
She died. And then everybody felt sorry like for the family, like it was a real family,
but
that she really
see,
died,
I can
and they kept watching it.
But I can see the like someone like Suzanne Summers doing that because she was still hot. But you don't wait till you're 50, especially as a female. I mean, that's how it is. You know, you gotta be fuckable, dude. We got to get back to these stats here, Joe. Just to let you know, when you're on the road, if anybody's planning a road trip, we got to let you know which states you definitely want to bag it in.
We got it?
Yeah, I downloaded some government report, which gives you the rate of all the different STDs per 100,000.
Okay.
So, Florida...
Wait, Joe, you want to take a guess? You want to take a guess?
Real quick, though, how far into this government report are we going to get before Billy starts conspiracizing on how it's a mind wash and how they're trying to fuck us out of something?
Well, this is their blueprint.
This is
who they want to attack, Joe.
Oh, 5.
All right, so Florida... What am I guessing here? The percentage of people that have AIDS in Florida?
No, the number of positive cases of gonorrhea per 100,000.
What's the number one state you don't want to bang in, Joe? What are you going to go with?
I'm going with Florida.
You going with Florida? I'm going with Georgia.
Well, you're looking at the fucking map, Bill.
I can't see it from here.
Well, we're all going to be fucked because we have to actually name these states because the name isn't on over the state.
Oh, so. Jesus.
Jesus,
Christ.
Danny. No, we're not fucked. I know what the states
if
are.
If you point to one over here, I'm not going to know.
You don't know what they are?
I have
oh
no clue.
Oh, my God. Danny
I don't know.
Is a fucking moron.
No, he's not. I don't know what they are either. I couldn't tell you what half of those states were.
You don't know what the states are, Joe? You go on... You go on the road. You don't look at a map where
no,
I'm going?
No, I don't, you fucking nerd.
Dude, that, you know something? I know where you're going with this, but that's not nerdy.
So wait a second. I'm a moron, but you guys are having a spelling bee later?
I know. No, I can see not knowing how to spell, but like, no, actually, you know what? You're right, because I use words all the time that I don't even know how to fucking spell to try to impress people. So, all right, so you guys are right.
Wait,
I'm just not a moron in this.
So I'm betting Florida. I know, and I can pick out Florida on a map without it being labeled.
So Jesus, Joe.
That.
Wow. You can pick that one
I'm
out?
Proud
How about
of
New
that.
York? Can you pick that one out, too?
I'm proud of that. New York, maybe. The
Louis.
I don't think you can hear
yeah,
out
let
there.
Him know we're going to be, because he's looking really depressed out there. Let him know we're gonna get him in
yeah,
here.
Yeah, I told him.
Okay,
told
all right. So,
no, Florida is not the the most infected state with gonorrhea.
How do you know, Danny? You don't even know what the fuck
well,
states are.
Well, I know Florida's right there, whatever that state is.
Can I do? I just saw where you pointed.
What is it?
It's towards the east.
No, it isn't.
It isn't.
Point to that. I want to see if you know what if you know what state that is. Go ahead. Point to. Danny doesn't know. Go ahead. Point to the state. What state is that?
That one.
What is it?
That one is.
He has a college degree. Unbelievable.
That one is. That's already, Alabama.
No, it's Mississippi. You fucking
Mississippi
idiot.
Is the highest.
Forget that it's the
Alabama's right next to it. Don't act like that's that way off. Alabama's right next to Mississippi.
Wow.
Alabama touches Florida.
Wow. Dude, that is some Bobby Kelly shit.
You just pointed. Did you just not point to the second state from the right?
No,
that one. Which one are you pointing? Oh, the third.
Fuck you.
The third
you're
one
not
over.
Getting out that's of that. You're not getting out of it. You're full of shit. Because not only that, if you thought he was just pointing Alabama, you would have gone to Alabama. But you were like, that one is, Wow. I remember a long time ago, Bobby Kelly, his booker called him up and said, yeah, I got you a college in Wisconsin. He goes, awesome. What state is that in?
I can just hear him.
Dude, what state is that in? Dude, you're right there with him, though.
Oh, gosh. That's hilarious.
Mississippi. Now.
Who would have thought Mississippi?
Dude, first of all, who would go to Mississippi? So I'm feeling really good about my chances of not getting gonorrhea.
Yeah.
At any point in my lifetime.
That's absolutely true. The I got so called to on another dumb thing the other night. I was talking to Russ Meneve.
About what?
And two of his friends. I don't
Russ
even
Meneve,
remember.
Russ Meneve, another comedian.
Yeah,
a whole chunk on rape. Yeah. Hilarious comedian.
His crowd work. I was laughing the other night because he does a joke about suicide.
Uh-huh.
And he goes, "So is anybody else suicidal like me?" And that's like crowd work and rushes his head. Yeah, but I go
suicidal. Come on, people, yeah. Back me up.
He cracked on me about something. I go, really? I go, why? Because I'm not a disturbed sycophant like you. And he goes, "Do you even know what sycophant means?" And I was like. No, I actually don't. He just called me on in front of a whole group of people, and we just started laughing. He's going, how fucking embarrassing that you just got called on it, you fucking idiot, you know?
Well, you're thinking, I got sick in there.
Yeah.
I got fant.
Exactly.
Sycophant. It sounds like psychopathic. Dude, we've been shooting this shit here for almost a half an hour. I think we got to take a break here. And that's it.
Next up, we're going to hit you with a greatest hit, bitch. Here comes the first motherfucking discussion from the very first motherfucking episode. Ah, shit. It seems like just yesterday these two motherfuckers started doing this motherfucking program. Well, fuck it. Here it is, the Navy discussion. Uninformed.
I did a show the other night at a club in New York, and I was talking in my set. I told a joke about a story, actually, about when I had gotten into a fight with some guys in the Navy. Uh-huh. And I said three times to the story, I go, I support the troops. I really do. But these guys were dicks. So I got into a big argument with them. And there were two people from the Navy in the front row.
Jesus, Joe, you're yelling at retards and the troops?
That kid wasn't retarded. He was a fucking
dick. Did you kick a puppy at the end of your last gig?
So I kept saying I support the troops, but there was these two people in the front in the Navy, and I said, hey, you guys are in the Navy too. I think that's great. And then I started to talk about how I don't really vote, and I kind of don't get into politics and everything. So after the show, I'm in.
What percentage of people do vote, Joe?
I'm going to go with 15%.
Okay. See, dude, you're still picking round numbers.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry. But after the show in the lobby, the chick that was in the front row from the Navy comes up to me and starts screaming at me, you're a fucking jackass. You don't get it. I put my fucking ass on the line for you. This chick's like 50, by the way. And I'm like, are you even in the Navy? Well, not anymore, but I was, and I put my fucking ass. And I go, lady, let me just say this. If you're going to make a statement, make it an intelligent statement. You don't know what you're saying right now. And she's yelling at me and yelling at me. And finally I go, lady, you know what? Fuck you. You're a fucking moron. Right? And her husband now gets in my
face.
Was
she still in uniform, Joe?
No. She was in regular cunt clothes. And then her husband
those
gets...
People that listen to here, you got to know about Joe. When Joe has these meltdowns, he usually does it in front of like somebody like... he'll yell at like one of those Salvation Army people with like the belt. It's like when Joe has like a meltdown, he's always like in front of a church.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really ever strike out against any real cause or legitimate effort or anything. It's always, you know, a homeless man. One time I tried to beat up a homeless man because he insulted Billy in the street, and I tried to fight him.
Oh, dude. This guy, Danny, how old was he?
Yeah, he's probably 65 years old. He's old.
Yeah, that 58 to 65, a baby boomer who just never happened for him, you know? This fucking guy, I don't know what happened. He started giving us shit or whatever, so I gave him a little bit of shit back. We were kind of drunk or whatever. So the guy comes down the street. It was me, Joe. We were two girls. It was like five of us in this group. This 58-year-old black dude comes running down the street. He starts doing almost like this I saw a karate movie in 1972 stance.
Yeah.
Going, come on, man, come on. I kept saying he looked like Marvin Gaye because he had this beard. So I kept singing, what's going on, as he's doing this shit. But Joe gets in his face like he's in an action movie. Like, you want to go? Let's fucking go.
Dude, he was fucking with you. Fuck
dude,
him.
And then you strutted away like you just went at it with some guy.
I felt good.
Yeah, like he was from Gold's Gym.
In my defense, we played beer pong in that bar for a good hour.
That's what he was. He had big, sad Marvin Gaye brown eyes,
He was a dick. But you know what's funny?
He was homeless, Joe.
Here's the common trait of the two stories. You sung What's Going On to the Marvin Gaye Guy. This military lady, I'm fighting with her and fighting with her. She won't listen to me. And she starts going, I'll protect your goddamn country. So I just started singing America the Beautiful. I was just like, America, America.
You know what? Here's a pet peeve of mine. I hate when people in the Navy say you're protecting our country. You're not. Okay? Who the fuck has a Navy out there? Didn't we destroy all navies after World War II?
Didn't we have that problem with those eight pirates in the rowboat?
Off the coast of Africa. Yeah, you got to wait for seven Zimbabwes with the outboard motor.
Yeah, there was that thing happened the one time.
Like, seriously, dude, if you were going to war, okay, say if you're gonna go into politics, so you needed it on your record that you didn't pussy out during wartime, and you wanted to go into service, the fucking Navy's the way to go.
Yeah, Navy.
You just sit off the coast.
I think you're absolutely right. Yeah, you sit in a little hubby, you eat some chowder.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, on your boat.
Exactly. I'll tell you, the only guys who get off easier are the guys with, like, in the Air Force with, like, the orange sticks that, like, guide the plane in, or maybe, like, the guy who sticks the blocks under the wheels.
I don't even want to be the guy with the sticks. I want to be the guy making the sticks. I don't even want to be out on the aircraft.
You drill the hole for the rope that they stick in there. So then one day you can flip out at a comedy club. I'm fucking protecting your ass.
Exactly.
Everybody acts like they're on the front line. I bet Navy SEALs and those guys fucking hate that shit. Everybody walking around.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah. Some guy that just had to slit some mercenary's throat.
some guy in the Navy sunning himself in the Persian Gulf on the deck of an aircraft carrier.
Yeah. Don't you love that?
Other guys in fucking Fallujah.
Yeah. Navy SEAL Johnson, we need you to infiltrate the desert and take out this czar. Miller, go guide this plane in. But yeah, you're both protecting the country.
Point in the direction that the plane's taking off. You ever seen that guy? You just got to take like a yoga class. So you can bend down far enough so you don't get sucked into the fucking jet engine. That's right. Here on Uninformed, if you're listening to this shit and you're in the Navy, we're saying, you know, unless you're a Navy SEAL, you know, go fuck yourself. You're not protecting us. All right? You're on a ship. You're on a cruise that's 4 years long.
What percentage? Now, honestly, not like.
I'm just trying to get some callers here.
Not our fake percentage. Honestly, what real percentage would you estimate of people in the military actually put their ass on the line? Like, are actually in the fucking fire?
18.
That's
18%.
About 18.
Yeah. If you got like, you know, you got a couple guys. What do we got like 7 jets over there. 7 to 10, right? No, we do it. I saw it on Wikipedia. We got like, yeah, if you're just tuning in, all this shit's backed up. We got encyclopedias right in front of us. We got like 11 jets over there, right?
All right.
That's a good number, Joe, if you're going to guess later on. I don't know. Yeah, it's the fucking guys, you know, you're on point, that Vietnam shit. All right, if you're in some computer guy,
you
ever see this shit like they try to suck you into getting in the military and they show the guy sitting in the control room in the laptop? I mean, that's basically...
I've actually gotten upset with my dad.
You're in a cubicle in the middle of a war.
I've gotten upset with my dad because he's in Vietnam, or he was in Vietnam, and I've actually gotten annoyed with him because he has no good stories because he worked in the fucking file room.
Exactly.
And I remember being a kid and be like, Dad, tell me a story about the war. And he was like,
My dad was in the Navy.
Papers.
My dad was in the Navy. He was in the medical corps, and they didn't even ship him to Vietnam. They shipped him to Chelsea Naval Hospital in Massachusetts. I mean, he had some incredible stories about wounds, but it's not like they were going, medic! And he was, you know, serpentining. Yeah, if there's any veterans out there that want to call up and, you know, actually seen some action. And do you get, like, annoyed with other people who start strutting around? Like, you know, they had some incoming when they were really just, you know,
it's true, cause
peeling fucking potatoes. What, do these lights mean that there's calls coming?
Yeah, we got calls. Actually, let's go to Ken in Massachusetts. Okay. His son is in the Navy.
Okay.
Ken, what you got?
Okay, you're telling me that the Navy doesn't play a role in the Army.
That's what I'm saying, sir. I'm saying it's a tugboat with a gun on the front.
Except Navy SEALs, Ken. Except Navy SEALs.
Okay. I don't know. My son was in the Navy, and he was in the USS Kennedy in Afghanistan.
Can you prove that?
Can I prove it?
Yeah.
He
just sounds like this is like off the top of your head, you know? You got any
statistics?
It's
not off the top of my head. But anyway,
you don't have to get angry, okay? You can just present. This is a very wide open forum, so I don't need anger.
He, they shot and they fired guns and they got 9 out of 10 major...
What's this, paintball?
Major tech points.
Major what points?
Yeah, dude, you're talking shop here.
Major target points.
But what were the major... What do you mean by they had 10 major target points?
This is right after 9/11. He was shipped out to Afghanistan on a JFK.
Uh-huh.
And they were ordered to fire.
Can you get to Afghanistan by a boat? I thought it's surrounded by land.
Well, that's the thing. That's the thing, Ken. It's like, how in danger are the boats wherever they are near Afghanistan versus the Army and the Marines? They're actually in the desert getting bombed in their bunkers and all that shit.
Yeah, well, they do play an important role, though.
Well, I mean, here's the thing. Here's my problem.
Yeah, they do. They bring over the guys who are going to get shot at.
Every time somebody says they're in the military...
Dude, you got to admit, man, if you're going to be in there, I'd rather be on a fucking destroyer.
Okay,
I have not seen any good Navy... Listen, sir. Sir, you're very hostile.
I'm not hostile.
Okay. Well, you're very passive.
I'm hyper, but I'm not hostile.
Ken, listen.
Okay.
You don't have to be proud just because your kid was in there. My dad was in the Army, and I'm not proud of him. He's got no good stories. His best story was that he saw the post office get blown up. That was the best thing he had to tell me. That's a shitty story. Not every guy propelled down a rope from the helicopter with a backpack on.
He got a Purple Heart. He cut his thumb peeling potatoes.
Thanks for the call, Ken.
All right, man. See, that's what I'm saying. You know what I mean? I mean, you figure. I thought I was really getting nervous. They're like, this guy's gonna be. Let me tell you something, you sons of bitches. Yeah. He was just like, you know, they had some ballistic.
Can we make a rule?
Apparatus.
I thought he was gonna.
I want to hear somebody hardcore. You know, who got into this shit over there. Do you get fucking annoyed by people who are trying to pretend like you know what I'm saying? It's just like when I worked in a warehouse, Joe. This is exactly like going to war. You know, I'd be like unloading the truck. I'd be unloading the trucks. No, there's a point here.
The ignorance, the level of ignorance already is astounding. I can't.
Yeah, but we're protected by the name. You're uninformed. You can't get mad at this shit. Okay,
oh,
look,
Jesus
Joe,
Christ.
I have to go with what I know. Okay,
I'm with you. I'm with you.
Right now, I know warehousing. Okay, with this goddamn internet. Okay, it's going to end it. Okay, because right. All boxes are going to become digitized. In fact, at least 43% of them at this point are digitized. It's not even matter. It's like Star Trek now. So, and if anybody wants to dispute that, I got the fucking facts in front of me. Anybody in warehousing that wants to fucking call this show up, okay? I will bury you with the shit that I can come up with about warehousing. This is my point. I hated when we went to the this is just like war. When I was working in the warehouse, and the company picnic would come along, and all these suits would put on their fucking t-shirts and their, you know, it's Friday dress down wear. Like they weren't making $100,000 a year, and they tried to act like grunts, and like they were unloading trucks.
I hear you. All right, I'll give you that.
Dude, I'm telling you, with the warehouse door open, the neighborhood that I was in, it was potential that you could get shot. So,
dude, it was the same thing.
Just like war.
It was the same thing when I worked for the Senate in Texas, and the senators,
they
I remember.
Have a Senate in Texas.
Yeah, the Senate's, believe it or not, the senators would have these like parties. You know,
did they know you were half Egyptian, Joe?
They didn't. They didn't.
You kept that low key down there.
It
huh?
was weird. Their nostrils would flare up a bit when I was around them.
Joe, did you mess with Texas?
But the whole thing was, the senators would have these parties, and they'd have like some kind of bluegrass band at their party, and the senator would come in boots and jeans, and they'd have a keg, and it'd be like, "Ah, get some gumbo, son. I'm just one of y'all." And it's like, "No, you're not. You're a fucking millionaire that lives in a mansion somewhere." I'm working for $22,000 a year in this shithole.
Dude, that is so much like fucking war. It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I'm talking about.
Exactly.
See, so we
That's
know.
My point.
Yeah, we know
That's
what
my
we're
point.
Saying. What percentage of people are going to die of heart disease in Texas?
Not enough.
You didn't have a good time down there, Joe?
Not particularly. I'm not knocking.
You don't look like a line dancer, Joe.
You know what? Here's what I didn't like. I lived in Austin. There wasn't. I was ready for shit-kicking hoo-ha Texas, and Austin is just the most liberal, bleeding-heart, pretentious cunt city
on the
fucking map, dude.
That's like when I moved from Boston down to North Carolina, and I moved down there, and I thought I was going to be the cool kid. I thought I was going to be, like, Footloose.
Yeah.
Like, they were all going to be, like, 20 years behind us. And I got down there, dude. They were doing more fucking drugs. It was, they listened to the same music.
Dude, it was so annoying.
Dancing wasn't outlawed.
It was so annoying. I was ready for, like, bar fights and beer brawls and shit, and then you get there and it's like, have you seen the new extended version of Nosferatu? Go fuck yourself. You know what I mean?
Oh, well, you should have gone to the Houston area. Once you get past the sea of fatness that is Houston, they were actually voted the fattest city.
I was afraid to go to Houston because the ghetto boys were from there, and that always sounded like a really, like, dangerous place.
What, because of one rap group, Joe? You live in New York City.
They were,
how many
they
fucking
were pretty
rappers
intense.
Are here? You know Jay-Z's
boys
from
were,
here?
Yeah,
50 Cent, all those Hot
the
97,
boys,
the lobby of Hot 97.
The ghetto boys just have songs about fucking dead bodies. So that's that, you know, I think that crosses a certain line.
Yeah, it goes into like gay. That's almost like death metal. Like, like we're sick.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I'm
it's
old.
Kind of annoying. You are old, but it's, you know, whatever. Who cares? What are you going to do? We had another caller on this military thing.
Oh, yeah. Let's try to stay on topic here.
Sure. Let's check out.
I want to hear somebody from the military that either defends the Navy.
Also,
if
anybody wants to call from Austin, Texas and try to defend that, I would love to.
That's great, Joe. Let's try to have 9 different topics going on as people call in.
Not right this minute. Just at some point.
Well, let's go to Trevor in Wyoming.
Okay.
Trevor.
Hello. Yeah Trevor.
Yeah, hello. Hey,
Hi.
I just got out of the Marines, and I just want to say that there's a lot of Army and a lot of Marines over there in Iraq that really don't do shit either. You know, like they go over there.
Let me ask you a question, Trevor. Did you do anything over there? Like Sheen makes the Iraq movie, is he gonna play you?
probably not so much, but
Emilio.
Anyways, infantry. I didn't sit behind a desk. That's for sure.
Now, let me ask you this. Do you get fucking annoyed by the guys who sit behind the desk? Do you think they should have a lesser uniform than you? Like, maybe they shouldn't have combat boots. Maybe they should have, like, camouflage, like, loafers or something, like, something of that effect?
It's disgusting that they get paid the same amount of money that I do when I'm when I go out and I get shot at and they sit on base all day. You know what I mean? Like,
well, dude, I worked in a warehouse, man. I know exactly what you're talking about.
They wear the same ribbon. They get the same awards. You know, like to a civilian or to a regular person, you look at two Marines or two soldiers, and you don't know the difference.
Well, let me ask you this: Have you ever caught one of those people behind the desk trying to act like they have some street cred over there, like almost like the whole rap thing, like trying to act hard and they actually grew up in the suburbs?
Oh yeah, dude, all the time. Like,
do you call them out on it?
Like, oh yeah, or you'll be in a bar and you'll catch some fag talking about how he thinks he's got post traumatic stress because he saw a dead body or something. You know, and you kind of go, you know what? You know, it's
because he downloaded faces of death in his cubicle.
Hilarious.
Trevor. Yeah, exactly.
Trevor, so I've always been dumbfounded by this. If everybody gets the same pay and one group has a shittier job and is in more danger than the other group, then why volunteer to go infantry? Or why, you know what I mean? Why not try to go desk job type of thing and still get all the benefits of the military, but not being shot at and all that stuff, you know?
Well, because that's for pussies, man. Like, who joins the Marine Corps to sit behind a desk?
I like you,
hey,
Trevor.
Hey, is that...
the reason why the people I know, and I don't want to say me, but the reason why they join is so they can go kill somebody or so they can go blow some shit up, not sit behind a fucking desk and...
Dude, why don't they have you in the commercial? You know what they should have? They should have the first half of the commercial where they teach people computers and all that stuff, and then you just bust in the middle of it with a fucking, like, AK just going, that's for pussies.
Yeah, Trevor.
The Navy is for pussies.
Trevor, if you would have called me when I was in high school, they would have had me. Because the guy that called me just went, I hear you play the drums, Joe. And I was like, yeah. And he goes, how'd you like to play them for your country? And I was like, eh, I really wouldn't, actually. If you would have called me, be like, dude, you want to go blow some fucker's face off? I'd be like, yeah.
You ever see that movie Uncommon Valor? It's just like that. There's going to be 50 of them and one of you, and you're not going to die. Well, listen, man, I got to tell you, I got nothing but respect for anybody who's over there. Christ, even if I was over there not seeing action, the fucking sunburn that I would get. But I'm just saying, man, the fact that you guys ought to get a little more money. But that's fun. That's funny. People fake it, like they've been, like, maybe seen some action, like the 40-year-old virgin.
Right.
So he tries to act like he got laid, and he's talking about touching titties, like, it's just it's like a bag of sand.
Well, the Wigger analogy you brought up,
hey,
suburbs,
easy there, Kramer. That's easy, okay? We don't need Jamie Masada with the fucking Laugh Factory logo behind him. Buddy, listen.
That's a perfect analogy.
Trevor,
though.
Thanks for calling.
Thank you, Trevor. That's a perfect analogy. Like, it really is. Like,
dude, all my analogies are right on the fucking money. Well, 90% of them.
90%. 75. Just out of curiosity, did we piss off anybody in Texas at all?
No.
All right.
Nobody.
Well, they think they all agree then.
No more Navy stuff? Because there's Steve in Long Island.
Yeah.
He actually agrees with you guys.
All right.
Steve.
Yo. Yeah. You know, the actual amount of people actually see action over there is probably like 5%. You know what?
I like this guy. He's using percentages.
1%.
1%? It's that low?
That low. I was over there in Afghanistan, and it was hot. And that was about, and I made sure the UN didn't get in our way.
Let me ask you, are you back?
Yeah, I'm back.
Listen to me, are you back? No, I'm calling from a fucking cell phone in Afghanistan. I'm really an idiot.
Yeah.
All right, when you go out to bars and try to get pussy, do you try to pretend like you saw
every single time?
You try to pretend like you saw action.
Oh, every single time.
Okay, can you do the voice? Can you do the voice?
I've
like
seen
things, man.
I've seen things. Yeah. You just don't ask questions.
Hold on, I'll be the chick. Let's role play it. Ready? Right. So I'm just standing at the bar. All right, and you're approaching me. So go ahead.
Hey, sweetie, what's going on? I was in Afghanistan.
Hey, yeah. What was that like?
The depth over there. It's awful.
Oh, my pussy's so wet.
Joe, that was the worst impression of anything. You sound like you were bombing an audition to be the next Muppet on Sesame Street. I don't know. It's a sock puppet with a high voice. Hey, that's amazing. I just made my voice go a little higher. There's no depth to this character whatsoever. Joe DeRosa, see?
On the spot.
Joe DeRosa.
I give you what I got.
Steve, did you get laid, though?
Oh, yeah, plenty of times.
Mm. It works. That's awesome, dude.
It works. Just the uniform.
Do you practice in the mirror to get that fucking 200-yard stare?
You know, it works every time when you shake your head when you give him the lines too. Like you got something else going on in the back of your head.
Oh, that's good. I like it. Oh, that's good, man. Yeah,
would you be offended if I tried that later on tonight?
You know what? I'd be offended if you didn't.
Okay, I got a green jacket. I might throw that on a little bit later.
Steve, come to the after party tonight after the show.
You got it.
Yeah, it's gonna be at where are we having it?
Yes, the Subway. No, it's going to be hot, man. There's going to be a DJ.
We're going to go to Playwrights Tavern after the show on 49th Street between 7th and Broadway for our little after party. So if you feel like driving out, we'll be there drinking quite a bit.
I'll be there.
Plenty of seats, people.
Yeah.
All right, thanks for the call.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, let's take one more. Do we have anybody who's in the Navy who's like pissed and saying,
is there anybody that doesn't?
My mop is defending your freedom?
You know, the funny thing is, no. I mean, everybody's saying, yeah, you guys are right. I was in the Navy.
Jesus Christ.
Let's talk to Cody. Cody in Austin.
We can't
What's
even
up, man?
Oh, Cody in Austin. Here we go. We'll get a little double shot here.
I was actually a nuclear engineer in the Navy, biggest fucking nerd job in the world, and I lived in Austin for like 10 years. So I can back you up on both fronts.
Yeah, there we go, Cody.
I got to tell you, man, the worst part, though, is not the assholes that you run into in bars and shit in the civilian world. The worst part is when you're actually in the Navy and you're fucking working in a shop with a guy. Like, he's, like, in charge of you, watch center supervisor or whatever, and he's like that. Because when he thinks he's all fucking gung-ho because he's throwing some chemicals and beakers and shit.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
He makes your life fucking hell because he wants you to feel like you're out there shooting people and stuff.
So you're basically saying that, like, this last guy was saying that maybe 1-2% of people actually see action. But you see people in the armed services every night, you know, saying that I'm defending your country and blah, blah. I guess they're speaking for that 1%. I understand it, but I think there ought to be like a teleprompter underneath. Like, technically, this person has never been shot at since his older brother bought a BB gun when he was 8 years old.
And that guy giving you shit, like your lab supervisor guy, that's some fucking pussy that's taking all in his insecurity shit out on you. You know what I mean? Like, he's fucking feeling shit for not being out there.
School wants to grow up to be a cop. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
The most shit growing up is the first one who wants to join the fucking police academy because then he'll have the power.
Right.
The guys that suck are the ones that stay in the military for fucking ever and rely on that crutch of coolness. Because now every time they go to a bar, people are buying them drinks and shit. Man, I saw some Navy guys in a bar 3 nights ago, and they were talking all this shit about Iraq and all that. And I kind of like to bait them a little bit. So right.
Did they know that you were in the service?
No. I don't even tell him. I just talk to him. Oh, that's really cool, man. Yeah. And then toward the end of the conversation, I pointed his arm and yeah, those two little feathers mean you're a fucking secretary. Shut the fuck up.
Ooh.
You know what I mean?
We should get you and the last guy to fight somewhere later.
I'm all for it, man.
Well, that's what sparked this whole thing is because that chick in the Navy screaming at me and she's like 50 and I go, lady, are you in the Navy? And she's like, well, not anymore, but I will. It's like.
When she was in the Navy, yeah, her job was to blow an admiral.
Here we go! Another classic from episode 1! Episode 1! Ha-ha! I like that shit! That sounds like some Star Wars shit! Anyway, sit back and check it! The game show, ho!
The reason that Nia is here is we're going to do a game show of sorts right now. Basically, what it was is it's always funny to watch politicians, when they're running for a certain office, try to sort of politically correct their way through a tough question to answer something.
They never answer the question.
Tactfully. They never answer the question. They never answer the question truthfully, that's for certain. So we were thinking we should do a game show where we get random, really hard questions thrown at us being Bill and Graham, myself. And the goal is you have to answer these questions truthfully, but without losing any votes. That's the trick. The second we smell bullshit, you get buzzed by the other players. And the second you spin it too hard into something else, you get buzzed. But also, if you're too brutally honest, you get buzzed too. So we understand the rules.
So we're basically sitting around going, these fucking politicians, they never answer questions. And then we're like, well, if you actually answered them honestly, you'd lose votes. And then we started talking shit, going, I could fucking do that. So now we're going to see.
All right.
So here's how it works.
We're going to do it. Go ahead.
Nia's going to ask the question. She's going to pull them randomly out of that. Some of them are easier than others, right?
Mm-hmm.
We'll go in order. Billy will get asked a question first. While he's answering his question, Nia, myself, and you, Greer, will act as the judges.
Okay.
When it's my turn,
how many points
you, Billy,
you get?
Nia, judge, okay. and
Got
so
it.
On.
This feels like when the electricity goes out, and you're like, "Fuck, we got to play a board game here."
We'll just give we'll give one point for question. Fuck it, and you got like 17 seconds to answer it. All right.
Wow.
So. No, we're very accurate. We do a lot of research here.
Okay. So here we are. This is Who Wants to Be a Politician?
All right. This feels like college radio. Fuck that. We did a great job for 2 hours and 40 minutes. There's going to be some shit.
This is where the show might jump the shark, but maybe not. I don't know. This might be funny. All right,
Nia. Let's.
With our host, Nia.
All right. So the first question.
For who?
For you, Bill Burr.
Okay.
Do Jews run the media?
Oh, wow. You hit me fucking hard right off the bat. Well, I would definitely say that there are a lot of Jews in the media, but to suggest that they're all working as one is a little too, I don't know. There's a lot of them. But no, I'd say that they don't. Why? Well, I didn't say anything anti-Semitic.
You backpedaled at the end.
But there's a bunch of Irish guys who are cops. You know what I'm saying? Everybody picks something that they run.
Well, you know what? You should have said that as your answer, and you would have gotten a point.
Really? You know what? You should stop being
so smug.
Time up? Shut
Is
up.
Time up
you
got to
stop being so smug like you're fucking up by 50 points.
His time's
Wait a second,
up.
Though. Where is the timer, though?
I'm holding it right here.
All right,
all right.
So you kind of included that last part.
Question. We got to keep it going.
All right, next question.
Uh-oh.
Who's this one? For Greer? Okay.
Greer Barnes, trying to get elected.
Are Asian people rude?
I wouldn't say that Asian people are rude. I just...
Yes, it's over.
No, I'm just saying...
You just lost Chinatown.
You know, it's just really, honestly hard to understand them at times. That's
And that explains
why. That's rude, right?
They speak loud because there's a lot of them. And they're all talking.
What?
So
it's getting worse and worse.
I don't, because they always go like that when they talk. You know, like, that's all I'm saying.
Alright, neither one of us again. Alright, Joe, you're the fucking big shot. Let's
17 seconds and up? When I went that was 17 seconds.
Oh. Yeah, and it's horrendous. Do you have a buzzer sound over there, Danny, so we don't have to listen to Joe's version of a woman coughing?
All right,
what do you got for Joe?
All right, for Joe DeRosa. Sweatshops, do you care? They're so far away, aren't they?
They are very far away. I think it is definitely an unjust policy that's going on over there. And... I don't think that it should be happening, but then again, we all need sneakers. So, you know.
Dude, you had it right there. You had it. You should have bailed right there.
Where are the places where there are sweatshops? The Philippines?
There you go.
Taiwan?
All that I don't know. As long as Foot Locker's full, I'm cool.
Oh,
I almost had a point. I did blow it. That sucks. All
right. Here's a good one for you, Bill.
Okay. I can do this.
Are women funny?
All right, go ahead. Next one.
All right, Greer, you're up.
That was brilliant.
All right.
He gets a point for that, right?
Greer.
Yes.
Oh, man. Mexicans. Mm-hmm. What's the big deal? They were here first, right?
I'm going to have to say no, they weren't here first. They weren't called Mexicans then.
Wow. There goes any Tex-Mex. All that shit's gone.
I let them go. and you can, let them go. Go back across the border.
Jeez,
Greer, what
did you
buzz
him? Jesus Christ.
Danny, you're falling asleep at the wheel here.
Yeah, how far is he got to go before he gets disqualified?
All right.
Right.
All right, Joe.
Yes.
Why do black guys have to be so loud?
I don't know,
I feel
but
like
it's.
You should be asking the black man that.
It's kind of annoying. It's nothing against black guys themselves, but they are loud and they do yell a lot. It's kind of.
Yeah. Thank you.
I don't be yelling.
Okay.
All right, Bill.
Yep.
At what age does someone become useless, and what should we do about it?
I would say 86 if you can't drive. And, come on, dude. I mean, I can't even get halfway through it. Who votes after 86?
Just to keep score, no points. Nobody has any points right
dude,
now.
You got it. You had half a point. All right, this is the last round here.
Oh, Jesus All right, Chris. Christ, mm-hmm. man.
Do you support the troops?
Absolutely. I just don't support the war.
Oh, dude. You hit.
Perfect.
There you go. Okay.
No, that was perfect.
That was good. All right.
1 point for Greer.
1 point for Greer.
Gonna be a black president. Come on, Joe. Step
okay,
it up.
Joe. Gay marriage, yay or nay?
Yay.
Yay.
Of course, I think
it makes
more
sense.
You
buzz him just to say yay. You fucking fag.
Yay.
It was written in the question, though. Huh? It says yay or nay.
And so. Joe wrote the fucking questions.
Oh. All
right.
All right.
Are we still doing this?
Let's
this
do one more quick round, and then we'll go to the porn right. stuff.
Bill, didn't we do more with this land than the Indians ever would have?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they're getting shit-faced out on the fucking reservation, so...
What, you guys don't want honesty in your politician? Okay? I'm Bill Burr. I say how it is. I say how it is. If you can't handle the truth, then I'm not the one that you want to have as your senator.
I can't believe you led that off with, yeah, absolutely, you fucking smug prick. Yeah, absolutely. Jesus Christ, dude.
That was brilliant.
All right. All right.
So
one more for Greer, one more for me, and okay. we're done.
Oh, all right.
Uh-oh.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I thought we were stopping
Joe,
after this
you
one.
Have to win.
All right, Greer. mm-hmm. Ooh. Is it time for a female president?
Absolutely.
This motherfucker gets all the easy no, but he's fucking questions.
Oh, yeah. Why not? I mean,
you're
yeah,
answering
absolutely.
Honestly, though?
Yeah, absolutely.
He's answering easily.
No, I'm answering honestly.
Well,
why not?
I believe him.
Seriously.
I believe him.
No, he's sincere.
Greer, are you currently in a relationship?
Yeah.
Are you happy?
Next
See,
question.
You don't want a female president. I was in his fucking
Look,
Watergate
no.
right
just,
there.
Just for the... Dude.
My relationship dude. Has nothing to do with how it feels.
No, we're running out of time. We have to get to bed.
Just for the warmth that he said honestly with. Okay.
All right. So, Joe, you think two guys making out is disgusting, don't you?
I absolutely do not. I think it's a beautiful thing, and two men should be able to love each other instead of being...
Dude, you just lost all the red states. You lost all the fucking red states. Greer Barnes with 2 points.
Greer Barnes wins. Oh all right. God.
We'll be right back with some choice cuts from the motherfucking Uninformed mixtape, bitch! Uninformed!
Alright, well, that sucked. To hear the Opie and Anthony Show 5 days a week, live on satellite radio, online on your phone or tablet, or even on demand, go to SiriusXM.com. Also, interact with the Opie and Anthony Show on Twitter, @Opie Radio, @Anthony Cumia, and @Jim Norton.